Welcome into Betts Memorial Stadium, where Cincinnati Christian University takes on Bethel University today in this Mid-South NAIA matchup. I'm James Opine, along with Rob Roberts. Roberts will be with you this afternoon, about 5 minutes away from kickoff. Bethel 4-0 on the season, ranked 23rd in the country. Cincinnati Christian looking for their first win, 0-5 on the season. Chris Elliott, the head coach of Bethel, is 24-26. For Bethel University. Meanwhile, David Fulcher, 0-5 in his first season as CCU head coach. Our own Rob Roberts caught up with Coach Fulcher a little bit ago and talked about this big Mid-South Conference matchup.
Now joined by head football coach David Fulcher for the third straight week. You're going to go up against a ranked opponent. This week, you welcome in number 23, Bethel. Your quick impressions of this football team.
Well, you know, anytime you're undefeated, you know, it's always good. Yeah, they're 23rd in the nation, but as I look at what they've been doing this year, I think we match up pretty well with them. I think there's an opportunity for us to go out and get our first victory as long as we can stay focused and do what we need to do.
You're going up against the number one running back in the conference, Ayante Davis, also eighth in the country at 119 yards a game. How do you try to slow him down tonight?
Well, you know, the one thing about it is that you can let him run all he wants, keep him out of the end zone, give yourself a chance to play, and it's one play at a time, and if you do your job, you can contain him.
This team comes in second in the nation, 344 yards a game rushing, a 3-1 rush ratio, but Kerry Sellers only completes 50% of his passes, just 3 touchdowns and 2 interceptions on the season. How do you make him a thrower and make him beat you with his arm?
Well, once again, if you can stop the running and make him throw the football and let him throw the ball in the air, we'll have a chance. But I think today you're going to see a different football team than we've seen in the past. As far as us, we're going to chase the football on defense, and we're going to make plays, and I think our offense is going to come alive today.
Now on the other side, their defense gives up 215 yards a game rushing, already giving up 8 rushing touchdowns. Frost and Ferguson each averaging over 4 yards a carry. They have to be licking their chops.
Oh, we are. We think that we can do a whole lot with this offense. We just got to get our offensive line to give those guys an opportunity to go through the line of scrimmage and make plays.
And now you're going back to T.J. Jamison, a quarterback. What's he need to do today to get the W?
Well, just control the offense. Don't do anything spectacular. Just get them up in the line of scrimmage. Do what you're supposed to do. Make the right checks, the right calls, and we'll be okay.
Now, we talked in our preseason video chats about no spring practice for you guys, and you didn't want to use that as an excuse, but you also said in those interviews it's going to take your team about 5-6 weeks, especially with the offense that you're running. Now we're into weeks 5 and 6, and you see it really starting to click a little bit. We saw a little bit against Georgetown. Talk about the direction of your team moving forward.
Well, it's always tough when you're playing in the first 5 weeks, teams are in the top 25. Yeah. Now we felt that the second part of our schedule would give us an opportunity to compete better, and then we're here now. So I think it's going to be a pretty good day.
All right, good luck tonight,
right,
Coach.
Thanks.
All right, back up to you, James.
It's going to be a big game here, and Rob joins me now. And you look at this, it's going to come down to the running game on both sides.
Well, you talked about it. You're going up against the number one rushing offense, averaging number two in the nation, 344 yards a game, but their defense gives up 215 a game. And Coach Fulcher talks about he wants to win with running and defense, and this is really a great matchup for him. And also on the Bethel side, they're without their top wide receiver, so now they're going to be forced to even be more of a runner. So now when Stills goes to throw it, he's not. He's going to tuck that ball and try to run even more, which plays right in the hands of that CCU defense. And we know the one thing with CCU is they have a very good front four. That run.
Absolutely. And Quincy Walden is out for Bethel today. He has a hip flexor injury, injured it on a punt return last week in their 35-28 win over Kentucky Christian. Look ahead now as the captains go out to midfield and shaking hands for the coin toss. And this one is going to come down to physical play. And even though Bethel is 4-0, I get the sense from talking to coaches, talking to players, that Cincinnati Christian feels like they can compete, feels like they can get their first win today if they do what they really set out to do all season, which is run the ball and play physical defense.
Yeah, but they are. They're 4-0, but the combined wins of the 4 teams they beat is 2, including a struggle against a winless Kentucky Christian team last week. They had to put a late score to be able to win that game 35-28. So 4-0, but not a very impressive 4-0. Only 2 wins get with those 4 teams combined.
And Cincinnati Christian wins the coin toss. They will receive, so they're going to get the ball first on offense. T.J. Jamison's going to get his shot here to lead the offense down the field to start out this game. And it's an interesting thing because I was talking with coaches. Not only has Bethel given up yards on the ground, they've also been susceptible to some deep passes here and there. They feel like they can get the ball downfield in key spots today.
Well, if you look at Bethel on the ages, they like to give a lot of cushion, 10, 15 yards down the field. Well, that's going to give Jamison a chance to do some quick hitters off the line, get him into that rhythm. We saw it in the scrimmage. We saw it early in the season. It takes them about a quarter and a half to be able to calm those nerves down, especially after being demoted to number two and being promoted back into number one. You just have to hope he doesn't try to do too much to keep that starting role. That's one thing you really got to worry about.
And that's the thing, is as the teams get ready, get set to run out onto the field here, they've had two freshman quarterbacks kind of shuffling. You have TJ Jamison, you have Braden Wammeldorf. Two weeks ago, we saw Wammeldorf. And here come the Eagles coming out on the field. They're excited. They think they can get a win here. But the quarterback shuffle, it's hard for an offense, especially without spring practice, like you mentioned with Coach Fulcher, when you've had some shuffling at quarterback. So it'll be interesting to see how they respond today.
But it's about the timing. When you're running that misdirection offense, how the running backs like it, the timing in between, each running back runs differently coming through their sets, and each wide receiver likes to catch the ball at a different point. And you finally get used to the timing of Jamison. You go to Wallendorf, now you're going back to Jamison. That's all about timing, and no spring practice, no winter conditioning.
Yep.
You keep going through it and through it, and football, especially on offense, it's very much a timing thing.
And you look at this, you look at the players right now, number six, you see him in the distance there on the left side of your screen, Jay Horton. He's a player to watch at cornerback for the Eagles. He was great against Georgetown, and he's played big all season on the outside.
Well, he's a difference maker. And not only he ranks number nine in D1, he averages two pass breakups per game, but he's also 37th in the country in kickoff return yardage, over 23 yards a pop. Really is a difference maker for this team in all-purpose yards as well.
And here we go. We're getting ready for the national anthem, it looks like. So we will pause for that when it comes up. But it's definitely a big one here in this NAIA Mid-South Conference matchup. It's Cincinnati Christian University against Bethel University. You're going to get that kickoff in just minutes as we turn it over to them as we have the playing of the national anthem.
Finally, for the safety of today's players, officials, and those involved with game management, entering the playing field at any time is strictly prohibited. It is a privilege for Cincinnati Christian University to accept Oak Hills High School's invitation to use their facilities, and we want to respect this space at all times. Cincinnati Christian University welcomes all players, officials, and spectators to today's contest. As a member of the NAIA, and the Mid-South Conference, we are committed to the true spirit of competition as champions of character, embracing five core values: respect, integrity, responsibility, servant leadership, and sportsmanship. And as a member of the National Christian College Athletic Association, we are committed to the game plan for life: love, integrity, faith, and excellence. We ask each of you as a participant, official or spectator, to abide by these values by creating a positive environment in which our athletes may participate, our officials may work, and you, the spectator, may enjoy. Please enjoy this afternoon's contest. This time, would you please stand and join me in prayer, followed by the playing of the national anthem. Please remove your hats and silence any audible devices. Giving today's prayer is CCU President Dr. David Ray.
God, thank you for the time to be together today. We thank you for the joy of healthy competition. We pray for safety on those at play. We pray for good sportsmanship to prevail on the field and among us who watch from the stands. And above all, God, may everything that happens today bring you glory. We give you thanks in Christ's name. Amen.
we're all set for kickoff here at Betts Memorial Stadium. Rob Roberts, James Erpine with you here for this NAIA matchup. Cincinnati Christian looks like we'll receive. They won the toss, so they'll get the first crack at this Bethel defense that's been susceptible to the run. And you mentioned it to Coach Fulcher, Rob, and Jordan Frost and Jared Ferguson both looking forward to this matchup, knowing what Bethel has done or not done on the ground.
Well, 4.3 and 4.0 yards for each rushing the football. So whenever you go up against a team giving up over 215 on the ground, but I think also this is a good game for T.J. Jemison as you're going up against a Bethel defense that also gives up over 220 through the air as well. So this team can be beat on the air and on the ground. And you have to believe that maybe you use the run to set up the pass in this game, give TJ some play action, get people out of the box, and let him go downfield a little bit more.
For Bethel, Casey Camerzell out today. He is not with the team, so Logan Wheat, the freshman, will kick and punt for Bethel. So that's something to watch. And you look at Cincinnati Christian as they get ready to receive the kickoff, and they got two men back there in the ever dangerous. We've talked about him some. Jared Ferguson back. That's the guy they want to get the ball to. And we'll see here what he can do on this kickoff. And here we go. Wheat has the sign, and here we go. We are underway here at Betts Memorial Stadium, and the kick is short. We mentioned he was a freshman, and it's going to be picked up, brought up the left side, and he's going to break it. And that is number three. He gets all the way up to the 46-yard line, and that is huge for CCU and a big start for them as they get this game going, a huge return.
Yep, as T.J. Jemison's going to take it, just one of 12 on the season, two picks just for 9 yards. But this is a different T.J. that we see coming through now as he has to go along with 18 carries for 29 yards. But I think you're going to see a totally different T.J., especially with the right arm.
And here we go. Jemison under center, first and 10 at their own 47-yard line is where the ball is going to be spotted. Three running backs in the backfield. Sends two men in motion. Sends another one. Ferguson in motion. He's going to hand it right up the middle to Garner Harris. Oh, and it's a fake. And it's going to be an incomplete pass. Faked it to Garner Harris. It was an option, a read option. Jemison threw it up there. And it's going to be ruled incomplete as it was a forward pass.
Yeah, very, very fortunate. It ended up being almost like a shovel pass. Spalding was able to get just ahead of him, but there you saw they faked that belly dive. The defense collapsed. Smart play there by TJ. He saw the defense collapse. The defensive end pinched in. If it had been a good pitch, you'd have seen Spalding, whose mama's in town from Houston, a surprise plane visit in last night. Got surprised before the game. We'll talk about that a little bit more, but you're able to complete that pitch, and he's got a lot of running room.
So here we go, second down, fortunate there, ruled an incomplete pass, 14-27 to go in the first quarter. Jemison under center, has three running backs in the backfield, two wide receivers split out left, and he's going to hand it off to Ferguson, left side, and he's tackled right away in the backfield by number 51, and right away the linebackers for Bethel getting up and stopping the run there.
Good pursuit there, Jeremy Johnson, able to get that 6'1", 232-pound frame in the backfield. Moves pretty good for a guy that size, able to wrap up Ferguson. But not where you want to be for Jemison and this offense. Never want to play behind the sticks, especially for a team that through the first 5 weeks has really struggled through the air.
Absolutely. I mean, you look at it, they got a huge return there, and now you're third and long. And Darian Pryor, was on that return, by the way. He was in the backfield for that kickoff instead of Jay Horton. So here we go, huge third down, third and long. They're going to pass it, roll out. Jemison looking downfield, and he's got his man, and there we go, completed. And that's number 81, and just like that, Daquan Bowman reels it in, but it is going to bring up fourth down as it gets him close to the 50-yard line.
Actually, 84, Marcus Holyfield out of Hoover, Alabama. But that was a good rollout.
There we go, and I did see the names wrong, but there's Holyfield on the side.
But how about Logan with the new knee brace this week?
Yeah, no, Logan Cassetto's on to punt for the Eagles. So, hey, that is encouraging, though. Jemison able to complete his first pass, even though they have to punt here. If he can get a good punt, there's Cassetto's with the punt. Should be able to, in a fair catch, and there you go at the 5-yard line, and the Eagles might not have gotten points on their first drive, but the big return set up that, which it's going to put Bethel on their own 5-yard line for their first drive.
But Joyke Upton, a junior out of Nashville, with a freshman mistake. Anytime you're inside the 9-yard line, you don't fair catch it. You let that ball hit the turf. Instead, he fair catches it at the 5-yard line, and now we're able to get a look at that CCU defense.
And here we go. So Kerry Sellers out, the senior quarterback, number 2 for Bethel. He's going to start in the shotgun, and this is a team that is going to run the ball a lot with Ty Davis and others, and Sellers certainly has running ability as well, and he hands it off to Davis up the middle to start this game, and he's going to get about 3 or 4 yards up to the 11-yard line, rather, as it's a gain of about 5 yards on first down for Bethel.
Good tackle there, Wyatt Jefferson, but how about the loss of James Johnson? Unfortunately, not with the team today, disciplined internally for reasons undisclosed, but that's a big loss along the defensive line, standout freshman defensive tackle.
Here it is in Bethel. Sellers going to keep this one a little bit of an option there. He's going to get up to about the 15-yard line, and that's going to bring up third and short for the Wildcats, as the Wildcats, two running plays. They expected this. You mentioned Johnson being out, and that is a big loss for CCU, as their defensive line is going to be busy. The Wildcats in the no huddle now. Third and short. They're on the 15-yard line. They have to get to the 16 for a first down. Sellers under center for the first time this drive. And he's going to throw it. And he looks, and he throws it to his star running back on the left side. One-hand catch. And we talked about Fitz. Fitz has it. And he has a first down for the Wildcats up to the 21.
Christian Williams was able to get to him, but just a little too late. But you see why he has a 50% completion percentage. Does Sellers. Having problems even completing the ball out of the backfield on a nice little swing pass. Very fortunate his tailback was able to get a paw on it.
So here we go. Sellers under center again, and he's going to hand it off to Fitz right side. He tries to bounce it out. Tackled after a gain of about 1 or 2 yards. And
Wyatt Jefferson.
And Jefferson with the freshman with a big tackle there. And it's going to be 2nd and 8 for Bethel. And the no huddle from Bethel, when you're talking about missing some guys on the D-line, yep. We'll see how CCU can respond, because this defense certainly not going to have a ton of time for rest or to get breath here as Bethel runs the no huddle. Sellers in the shotgun. He's looking to pass, looking left side, under pressure a bit, steps up, and he's got his man. Number 4 with the catch, and that's Jaquiz Upton. The 5'9 junior filling in for Quincy Walden today gets the start. Walden out with a hip flexor injury. And he's going to get all the way down to about the 30-yard line into CCU territory. And you see Sellers poised in the pocket there.
But look at that pocket.
And finds his man.
You got that much time, you're going to be able to pick some people apart. Very fortunate Christian Williams was able to track him down.
And here we go. Sellers again, no huddle. Even though they have the big gain, they're on the 28-yard line now. And here we go. Sellers, shotgun snap. And he's going to hand it off right side. And that's number 29, Octavian Burrell. And he's going to get it down to the 24-yard line, a gain of 5.
Good tackle there. Trevor Wobio is a 5'10", 215-pound freshman. He doesn't bring him down there. That could be that might have been a dash for the pylon.
No huddle continues. Sellers in the shotgun. Has one running back next to him. Upton at the bottom of your screen. He had the big play that put them in CCU territory. Senior quarterback Sellers, he's making an adjustment here. He takes the snap. It's a handoff left side, and it's blown up right away. And that is a huge play there by number 9 in CCU, just like that. Huge play.
How about Switzer? Able to step up in the hole, able to wrap him up right there. From his will linebacker position, able to wrap him up and throw him down. Now another third down and long to go. Got to get off the field.
And this is big here for CCU. They force him into third down. They've been on the field 9:34 as the clock begins to tick here in the first quarter. And Sellers in the gun. And he's going to fake the handoff, throws right side. He's got his man, and he's got a first down and more. And it looks like that is number 21 on the catch, Jaquel Fitz, his fullback. And so far what we've seen from Sellers is poise, and they've been able to throw and pass it on this drive as they run the no huddle.
But that's also the second time they haven't picked a running back coming out of the backfield, and you have to believe that's one of the things the defensive coordinator is going to address when they come to the sideline. You got to pick up the running back out of the backfield.
Sellers in shotgun, takes the snap, and it's a handoff right side, and it's going to go in for a touchdown, and that's 34, Devin Raymer, who didn't get the start today, but the senior able to get a touchdown, put the Wildcats on the board as he ran it up the right side. Just great blocking there from Bethel, and CCU unable to get anyone out there to make the stop.
Exactly the start if you want, if you're a Bethel team, able to get it going not only on the ground but also the air as well. I think maybe catching CCU off guard a little bit with how much Sellers is throwing the football down the field.
Freshman punter Logan Wheat on for the extra point. The kick is up. It is good. And just like that, 95 yards. Bethel takes it all the way downfield and scores. They use the no-huddle offense behind quarterback Kerry Sellers. Big play on that drive was a pass up the left side to Jaquez Upton. And with 8:54 to go here in the first quarter, Bethel has a 7-0 lead as Cincinnati Christian had the big return, unable to cash in. And then the defense, they forced a third down, just unable to get off the field.
Well, you got to get off the field on third down, but the one thing that Bethel can do is they're sixth in the country. They convert 50% of their third downs. Anytime you can convert that much on a third down, you're going to be that's a winning formula right there. But you saw the no huddle, and everyone knows CCU likes to rotate 7-8 defensive linemen throughout a drive. Hard to rotate people when they come right back to the line and just snapping that football on you. So the depth that's usually in favor of CCU kind of going against them as they're unable to get those fresh bodies in every other play.
Yeah, so we'll see here. It really important. We're talking about the no huddle and what Bethel's doing on offense. It's important for TJ Jemison, this running game for CCU, to put together a sustained drive so the defense can have a breather.
Well, that's kind of been the story of the season, mm-hmm. is getting the offense to give the defense a break. Their defense can only do so much, but when you're on the field 40, 45 minutes out of a game, you're eventually gonna start to wear down a little bit.
Logan Wheat on to punt or to kick. He is the normal punter, but he has the kickoff for the Wildcats, and he kicks it off right side, and it is going to go to Darian Pryor again. He's going to be able to return it. He's up to the 20, and he gets brought down right away. So the Wildcats adjust, and after giving up a huge return to Pryor to start this game, he gets brought down at his own 20-yard line where TJ Jemison will take over.
That's going to be interesting to see what kind of play calling we have here. Do they go back to the play action on the early downs, or do you try to get Ferguson and Frost going? We didn't see Frost run the ball in that opening drive, but the Spalding option would have worked if Spalding would have been able to handle the football on the pitch.
Yeah, we saw that Jemison on third and long, they weren't afraid to pass it. They hit Holyfield on the right side. So we'll see now if that builds a little bit of confidence. They know what they're dealing with as far as the Bethel Wildcat offense goes.
Well, you see it here, bottom of your screen, 8-yard cushion. Now he's backing off. You're almost at 10 yards on each on the wide receiver.
Here we go, first and 10 on the 20. Jemison sends a man in motion, Frost in motion, and he's going to get the pitch on the right side. He cuts it back, avoids a defender, gets up to the 21-yard line, takes a big hit. But that's the thing, you had a defender right in the backfield. Hard to get going if you're Frost and you're that running game when you're already making moves at 5 yards behind the line of scrimmage.
But that's just communication along your front line. You're supposed to block the person that crosses your face, and they're just missing on that down block. But they're not playing from behind the chains. Get a couple yards, set up your second and medium, try to get four or five more, then you set yourself up for a third down in about 2-3 range where you keep your whole offense still wide open.
Second and 8. Holyfield at the top of your screen. One wide receiver outside, 3 running backs in the backfield. You see Jordan Frost, Garner Harris, as well as Jared Ferguson. He takes the snap, and it's going to be an option run, and it's going to be Jemison on the keeper. Looks like he gets it up to about the 25.5 yard line. A pickup of 4 there. And you're right, third and manageable for the Eagles.
I think that might have been a busted play because it looked like Jemison wanted to hand the ball off, but the running back had already cleared through and there was nobody behind him. So he did the smart thing and just tucked it. His instincts took in, he got what he could, but a third down and 3, that's where this offense needs to be able to convert, give that defense a break, pick up a couple first downs.
So here we go, 3rd and 3 on the 26-yard line, 7:20 as the clock continues to run here in the first quarter. Jemison barking orders to his wide receivers. Holyfield at the bottom of your screen, they threw it to him
down
on
to 5
last
on the play
drive.
Clock.
They get the handoff, they look for Holyfield, and big catch, and that's going to be enough for a first down. And he just climbed the ladder. And Marcus Holyfield, or Holyfield, is 6 foot. Looked a lot bigger on that when he climbed the ladder.
Well, we saw him actually trying that same exact play in the pregame warm-ups. We were down the sideline. Holyfield able to use that 6 foot, 175-pound frame, able to get up. He caught the ball at his highest point, and that's a big first down for this Eagles offense. Get some momentum going.
It is, and now you see T.J. Jemison 2 for 2 on the day. Ball on the 32, first and 10. And here we go, a little confidence for the young quarterback. You complete a couple passes. That helps any quarterback, yes, absolutely.
And we know confidence is a big thing, especially when you got a freshman quarterback. Get those nerves settled down.
First and 10, and it's going to be a handoff to Ferguson. He takes it up the middle, and he's going to fall forward up to the 35-yard line and a gain of about 3 yards. On first down, it'll be second and 7 on the 35.
Jeremy Ballou was able to get his hands on him and able to slow him down and eventually drag him down for only 3. Otherwise, Ferguson might still be running. Very good play by the middle linebacker.
And you see it here, Ferguson up the left side. And you're right. It looked like he had an angle, had a lane, and it closed quick. A couple guys there. You said Jeremy, number 40, and another Wildcats defender closing that hole quick, but second and 7 now. Jemison under center, 3 running backs in the backfield, sends Frost in motion, bobbles the snap, and he's going to just take it on the left side, and he's going to get 5-6 yards or so on the scramble. And I think that was a bobbled snap turn good for the Eagles offense as Jemison uses his athleticism to turn nothing into something.
As you talk about that, Coach Fulcher talked about that the whole preseason. He's even talking about that recruits. He goes, I don't need football players. I need athletes. I could turn athletes into football players. But you see the instinct, able to pick up the ball, got what he could, 3rd down and 1, right where this offense, once again, playing right where this offense needs to be. You pick up another 1st down, give that defense a few more minutes, but they're picking up momentum, and they're getting a good push now along the front line.
About 5 minutes to go here in the first quarter. CCU on their own 41-yard line, looking to extend this drive. 3rd and 1 to go. Jemison under center, 3 running backs behind him. He takes the – oh, no, he's going to keep it.
He's got it.
Up the middle, and he pushes forward in – that option is so dangerous when you have an athletic quarterback like Jemison and 3 running backs that could be getting the ball, and Garner Harris, Jordan Frost, and Jared Ferguson, the linebackers for the Wildcats. It just puts so much pressure on them.
And then wait till he fakes that, takes a step in, fakes that quarterback keep on the option, takes 3 steps back, and chucks one deep.
So here we go. Jemison picks up the 1st down, ball on the 43-yard line. Cincinnati Christian back-to-back 1st downs here. And they've Jemison 2 for 2 on the day. He's also had a couple quarterback keepers.
So smart decisions, though. That's what you want to see. He starts to grow up throughout the season.
And the Wildcats defense scrambling with guys on and off the field. And here's the snap, and it's going to be a handoff right side, Jordan Frost. And he gets about 2 yards or so. Well, they're going to say 1 yard up to the 44-yard line, and it'll be 2nd and 9 for the Eagles.
But you're still keeping all those options open. And you've got to remember, as an offensive coordinator, what you run now is you're trying to set up plays for maybe the next quarter, maybe 4 or 5 plays from now. And you have to believe that they're going to start using that play action a little bit more, because now they're running that 34 defense, and you're seeing those linebacks creep up closer and closer, and you have to believe that they're going to start taking some shots down the field.
We will see how that works. They definitely mentioned that in the pregame as we talked to coaches and players, that they thought they would be able to at some point take shots down the field. Haven't seen it yet. Jemison rolls out, and this is going to be a toss, and he throws it down the field, and that pass was intended for
Payne.
Number 17, Peyton Payne, and he just threw it there out of bounds, just out of just off target.
But even though it was incomplete, you know what that throw does? It gets people out of the box, and it opens up Ferguson, and opens up the quarterback keep as well, and for Jordan Frost. Sometimes an incompletion does wonders for the rest of your team as well. Get those linebackers out of there.
And here we go. It's 3rd and 9, and this is something that the Eagles haven't faced at all on this drive, is 3rd and long. So here we go. T.J. Jemison under center. 3 running backs in the backfield. No wide receivers split out in a running formation.
Down to 7 on the play clock.
And there we go. He motions Peyton Payne at the bottom of your screen. And it's going to be a handoff. Trick play, and it's broken up in the backfield.
And that's just a tough play to execute on third and long. And Frost able to come up with the recovery as Casetos and the Eagles punt special teams unit will be have to punt.
It's definitely an interesting a play call given the down in the distance and where you're at on the field to be able to try to run that double reverse. Definitely interesting. I know you're trying to catch him by surprise, but Jemison looked pretty good. It feels pretty comfortable throwing the ball down the football field today.
Well, that brings up fourth down, fourth and 16 as the clock continues to run here. About 2:40 to go in this first quarter. Casetos with the punt. And I didn't get all of that one on the left side. And it's going to bounce. And it's going to take a Wildcats bounce at the 45-yard line. And that's a tough punt for Casetos, who we've seen has a huge leg. Didn't get that one. Didn't get the best one there.
That's good if you're Rory McIlroy with a pitching wedge and you're trying to draw it back, but not good if you're a punter trying to pin him deep. But it looks like he felt the pressure, though, and for the first time we see him with that knee brace on when he had that punt blocked against him against Georgetown a couple weeks ago, and you've seen the ball come off the side of his foot. But unfortunate, but one thing we know is that kid can kick a football.
Absolutely. So I get a mulligan for that one, and here we go. Kerry Sellers in the Wildcat offense back in the field. Devin Raymer on the left side next to him, and it is going to be a keeper. Sellers is going to take it up the right side, and he is speedy, and he's going to get it into Eagles territory and get down to the 42-yard line.
Sellers also a runner, though. 52 carries for 384 yards a season. I mean, he's averaging 6.2 yards a rush. He's only completing 50%, but when you can add that 6 yards a pop on the ground, it's definitely going to help your offense.
It's going to help his average, too, as he picked up 11 there. This one's going to be a handoff up the left side. And Tay Davis is going to take it all the way untouched to the end zone. Multi-talented running back. They like to get him the ball. And he makes a huge play right up the middle. The 6'2", 235-pound sophomore with a 42-yard touchdown. And just like that, Bethel has a 13-0 lead here in the first quarter.
Well, what you saw there also was Brian Taylor on that safety position, or Michael Marble. The strong safety came in, took a bad angle, and that's when the seas parted, and doesn't get much easier than that for a tailback.
And Logan Wheat on for the extra point. It's up.
He almost got to
and
it.
And, yeah, almost blocks it. Doesn't. Yeah, just like that, 14-0. So now a quick strike Bethel after we've seen a 95-yard drive from Bethel. Two plays, 40 or 55 yards, and just like that, Bethel has a 14-0 lead. And that puts more pressure on this Eagles offense to get something going. They did on that last drive, unable to get on the board. Gonna have to get some points on the board here soon.
You gotta start answering back with some points, but it was a very good a drive last time by this offense. Able to pick up a couple first downs, but once they got behind the sticks, that third down and long, we kind of saw the struggles, but.
In that shot, you see Braden Wommeldorf. He started against Georgetown a couple weeks back. TJ Jemison gets the start at quarterback today. And Jemison so far 2 for 3 on the day and playing pretty well, I would say, so far. They've been able to move the ball some, just unable to get points on the board. This is a big drive for the Eagles as they look to answer.
You got to get some points on the board, but the one thing I've liked is the decision-making. Pitching it when he needs to, giving it to the right tailbacks, and making good decisions when he does throw the football down the field. Something we saw, it could have been nerves in that first game, you know, first ever game in the program. Now he's making decisive decisions. Back then he was thinking, now he's reacting.
And here we go, the freshman punter Logan Wheat kicking off today. As we mentioned, he kick off right side. And number three, trying to break it across, doesn't, and Darian Pryor, I think he wanted more there, had a lane on the left side, passed on it, tried to break it back and spring a big play. And that's just something, as you watch this play, he wants a lot because he knows that they need a big play, unable to get it there.
Well, he almost got the big block from Daquan Bowman. He's able to pick up that block. He's going to have the near side, and then you're just racing down the sidelines at that point using just your pure speed.
So it's going to set up the Cincinnati Christian offense at their own 20-yard line. 1:53 to go here in the first quarter. They picked up a couple first downs on their second drive of the game. We'll see what they can do here. TJ Jemison under center sends Frost in motion. It's going to be a handoff up the middle, and breaking it up the right side is Garner Harris. Harris up to the 24-yard line and a pickup of 4 on first down. Sets up second and 6.
And you know Mama's got to be happy seeing that coming all the way from Texas. He hasn't seen his mom since move-in day in August.
And we talked about that. Head coach, our assistant coach Brian Westbrook, we talked with him before the game. And Garner Harris able to meet with his mom here today, all the way from Texas. So she's probably excited to see her son playing in a college football game in person.
He was definitely surprised, got caught up in emotion a little bit. I know we all got caught up in it a little bit when you see something like that, especially when it's he FaceTimed her this morning, so she totally had him fooled.
And this is going to be a handoff up the left side. Nope, and it's a pitch to Jared Ferguson on the left side, and that's that option play. They're faking me out. They're faking the Wildcats defense out, and it's enough for a first down. They're going to mark it at the 32-yard line.
But how about the decision? He made a quick decision. He saw that once again, that defensive end's crashing, pulls it out of the belly, goes on the option. You'd like to see maybe a little bit crisper on the pitch, but he was still able to get it out to Ferguson. You picked up 9 yards and a big first down.
So it's going to be first and 10 on the 32-yard line. 40 seconds to go. Probably going to be the last play here in this quarter.
Quick first quarter.
Yeah, it was. Well, a lot of running plays. You know, you had the Wildcats in no huddle. You had the Eagles moving the ball some here. So very quick first quarter here. 20 seconds to go. Jamison under center. You have Hollyfield at the bottom of your screen. He has 2 receptions on the day. It looks like it's going to be a false start there. We'll wait on the call. It looks like it was number 61, Trevor Glasgow.
One thing, coaches, they can handle physical mistakes, but they don't like the mental mistakes, and that's what you saw there, the only guy along the front that moved. And now you're playing behind the sticks. It's going to be first down and 15. And with the way both teams like to run, you know possessions are going to be at a premium. So if you fall too far behind, your chances to come back are going to be very limited.
And that is going to wrap it up for the end of the first quarter. The Bethel Wildcats lead the Cincinnati Christian University Eagles 14-0 here. And you see a couple highlights here. This is how the game started, and it was a huge return for Darian Pryor, but the Eagles unable to cash in. This was the first touchdown of the game, and that was fullback Devin Raymer with the big play there. And this ended a drive for Cincinnati Christian, where they put together a few first downs. And then we talked about him in the pregame. Jaquel Fitz, right up the middle, untouched, with the touchdown. The sophomore running, or a junior running back, rather, with the touchdown there. So, and actually, I misspoke. That's Tay Davis with the score. We talked about him in the pregame, though. So as we get this second quarter started, Rob, Bethel leads 14-0, and CCU has the ball. I think what they need to do is just be patient on offense, because so far what they're doing is working. Unable to get a third first down on that second drive, get points on the board. But they put together 2 drives now where they picked up first down.
I think offensively they're fine. They just need to finish. They're getting the drives. They're getting the first downs. They're getting yards. But eventually you got to finish, start putting points up. Defensively, it's just staying disciplined. You got to stay in your gaps. You got to play assignment football. You see a couple of the guys that are over-pursuing. We saw that with the strong safety on the last touchdown run. He bit down, took the wrong angle, and that left the whole backside open. And the running back was just able to walk in from 39 yards out to Davis.
Going to be first and 15 after the false start penalty.
And you can't play from behind the chains. That's where those mental mistake penalties kind of come back and bite you.
Well, in this penalty puts them, you're right, it puts them in a bad position because they like getting 4 yards, 3 yards, and then getting the first down on third down. But they're first and 15 here. They're going to run the formation. We'll see a lot today with the 3 running backs. Jordan Frost on the left side, Hollyfield at the bottom of your screen, the lone wideout split on the left, and he's going to send Ferguson in motion. He's going to keep it, and Jamison gets it up to the 31-yard line, a pickup of about 4 yards to start there.
That was a smart decision. You saw Ferguson coming along the near side. The DB already has stepped up and already took the pitch away. Saw it happening before it actually did happen, able to turn it up. He got the 5 yards back, just a second down and 10, but that decision-making, he's not thinking anymore. He's finally reacting a little bit more.
So it'll be second and 10 after a pickup of 5 from quarterback T.J. Jamison. Marcus Hollyfield at the top of your screen, number 84. He has 2 receptions on the day. Frost at the bottom of your screen. And this is going to be a pass, and he's looking. It's a bootleg, and he throws it after taking a huge hit, Jamison. And that was intended for Hollyfield.
He's slow to get up.
And Jamison took a huge hit there, and he is down on the field. And that was a bootleg, and you saw right away that
he didn't feel the pressure coming along the back. Took a big hit, a legal hit. Took a big hit right when he was throwing the football.
And that was Dylan Benson on that play.
And now you got to get the backup. Good thing, but he's got game experience. But the one thing is, we also know he also has a tender shoulder that he took in that Georgetown
game.
So
here we go. And there's the hit he took as he gets rid of the ball there. And Dylan Benson just got a head of steam. He was running across the field on that bootleg. Didn't feel that pressure as Jameson
like
got
whiplash.
Rid of it. Absolutely. I mean, if you don't feel it, and that's the thing. He might just have the wind knocked out of him as Jameson gets up under his own power walking. We'll see how injured, if he's able to return to the game. Braden Wammeldorf,
but
obviously
he's got experience, and he's ran this offense, and the guys are comfortable with him.
All right, Braden, let's go to work.
Has the big arm, but once again, just a freshman. Sometimes you have to learn how to use that big arm. A lot of these kids come from high school systems where you're more emphasis on your legs, and we've seen that team's leading rusher.
And Jameson now looks to be okay talking with head coach David Fulcher. We'll see if he comes out for one play or if he's out for a while here. So number 19, Braden Wammeldorf, we saw him against Georgetown. We've seen him a couple times this season, certainly capable of running this offense, certainly athletic enough. And we'll see here, especially it's third and 10 now, third and long. You have your backup in. What do they decide to do? Do they decide to hand it off, or are they going to throw it?
2 of 9 on the season, 34 yards, does have the touchdown, but more known for his legs, 159 yards and just 29 carries.
And Wammeldorf is going to pass it. He's looking downfield, and he's going to make up his mind and run it. And a great juke move. And just like, oh, and he loses the ball. And he lost the ball. No defender around him. And it looks like that is going to be Wildcats ball. And Wammeldorf, after making a great play, lost the ball. And Rob, this is why. And everyone at home is going to say, how do you do that? Well, he's a quarterback, and he has it in one hand. And he starts running.
Got to tuck it.
Didn't tuck it.
You got to tuck the football tight to your chest.
And that's just, look, and this is a great piece of running. Makes one man miss, makes another miss, and he's got the first down. Doesn't tuck it. And he goes to tuck it, and instead he just, it just flings out there while his arm's moving. That's just a bad break from Wammeldorf, who clearly has shown he has the skills to play in college football to be a big-time playmaker. So here we go. Wildcats get the ball on their 50-yard line. Senior quarterback with the handoff, and it's a guy we're going to be talking about a lot. Already has one touchdown today. Tay Davis picks up 3 yards on first down.
Good step up there by the free safety, Michael Marble. Able to wrap him up and almost was able to get the strip out of there was Tyler Shoby.
Second and 10, it's going to, or second and 8, it's going to be a pass, and he finds his man right away, and that's going to be a first down. Number 14 with the catch for the Bethel Wildcats, and man, it's just one of those things. That's Vonta Owens with the catch, and it's one of those things where you have a senior quarterback, and he's just making all the right reads, right decisions so far for Kerry Sellers.
Well, he's
in
had
a no huddle.
He's had a very good pocket to throw out of as well. When you have a clean pocket, you're able to get comfortable and look down the field. But we talked about the two running backs out of the backfield. Well, that time they forgot to cover up the tight end on that play action.
And here we go. Sellers passing again, and he's got his man, and it's going to be another first down, and he's all the way down to the 13-yard line. And that's number 11, Breon Melvin, the junior wide receiver, up the left side, able to get another first down. And here's the thing, is on offense, you know your defense is struggling, and the turnover, it's just huge because it shifts momentum. And the Bethel offense, they're going to make you pay for it. They've proven they can score the ball in a hurry.
Well, they were picking on Christian Williams, and just like that, he checks out. And that's why CCU is going to take the timeout. I don't think they like some of their defensive matchups as they're getting gas for some big chunk yardage. That's something we really haven't seen this team give up, is a lot of big plays on the defensive side. They've been really sound on that side. Their problem has just been being on the field too long. But today has been the opposite. The offense, minus that turnover, has been able to pick up some first downs, eat some clock, and give the defense a break. But uncharacteristic, giving up the big plays.
12:43 to go here in the first half. Bethel leads 14-0 and threatening again. They're on the Cincinnati Christian 11-yard line. It'll be first and 10, so they could pick up a first down at the 1-yard line. And they take a timeout here, and I imagine David Fulcher really trying to solve this Bethel offense, because the defense so far, we talked about it at the top, without James Johnson, without Eric Perry, and they've struggled to get pressure on Kerry Sellers, and they've struggled to really interrupt the run game or interrupt anything the Wildcats have tried to do on offense.
Well, Johnson was a guy that could play defensive end and defensive tackle and was always in the backfield, very disruptive. Of course, at Mississippi Valley State, a transfer, but you got to at least hold him to a field goal attempt here. You don't want to go down 3 touchdowns.
All right, so here we go. First and 10 on the 11. It's going to have a 2 backs in the backfield. It's going to be a pitch on the right side. Tripped up at the 10-yard line. That's number 29, Octavian Burrell, the freshman, with a gain of about 1 yard there. And it looks like a Cincinnati Christian defender.
How about Switzer?
Slow to get up.
Switzer able to tackle him, able to hold him to no gain, but you talk about a disappointment there in the backfield. 41, Wyatt Jefferson had a chance to wrap him up for about a 3-yard loss, just went unable to get his hands on. Once again, just talking about just over-pursuing along that defensive side.
And that's number 93, Vince Hill Jr., trying to get off the field here. He's
that's a lot of man down there, too.
Slow to get up, limping off the field, and it looks like it's a leg injury as he limps off the field.
But that's one of your big body defensive tackles that you use to take up the center, take up the guard, and let your linebackers come down and clean up all the mess, and now you're down another.
All right, and let's take a look at what happened here. Take a look at the left side, and there's number 93 being blocked.
And
you see it as it slows down there, and he falls down to the ground.
Just got rolled up on a little bit.
Yep, looks like he got rolled up on. He's walking off the field very gingerly, but able to get off under his own power. We hope Vince Hill Jr. is okay. You never want to see injuries. And it's going to be 2nd and 9 now on the 10-yard line. The clock continues to run. Just over 12 minutes to go here in the first half. Bethel looking to extend their lead up 14-0 here against Cincinnati Christian. Kerry Sellers in the shotgun. Has his star running back Tay Davis in the backfield with him. He's going to throw it. Looks right side. Doesn't have someone. Rolls out. And he's got his man in the end zone. That's going to be a touchdown. Great poise there. And that's number 14. We saw him once earlier in the drive. Vonta Owens, the tight end with the touchdown. And you just see just great play there to extend the play and find his man down.
Well, they were able to improv, and Tyler Shoby got caught looking in the backfield just a little bit, just enough to let the tight end release off of him. And they teach you to roll with the quarterback when he starts to break contain, and he's able to find him in the back of the end zone.
So with 12:02 to go, extra point no good there, by the way. Logan Wheat, the freshman punter, who normally doesn't do the kicking. Casey Camrazel usually kicks. He's out today. So Logan Wheat on for the kick. He missed that one. So it'll be Bethel 20, Cincinnati Christian nothing. And you see he just hooked it right there. And Cincinnati Christian gets a break there. Now down 20-0. And here's the thing is we've seen this offense, the Cincinnati Christian offense move the ball. Going to have to put it together all together here and get some points as you see the medical staff looking at number 93, Vince Hill Jr. It looks like it's that right ankle, that right foot. And hopefully he's okay because they're going to need him as the defensive line for the Eagles already pretty banged up, already shorthanded today, I'd say.
Down 2 guys already, but the big one is the miss of Johnson. But, you know, it's always next man up. And that's what you're waiting for. Who's going to be that guy that's going to step up and take that role of leadership along that defensive line and make a play in the backfield?
And there's another look at the touchdown. As Kerry Sellers, guy in his face, doesn't matter, rolls out, gets hit after he throws it, and the senior quarterback so far playing great, not only with his arm, also with his legs. So here we go. Kickoff now for Bethel. Logan Wheat on to kickoff. And the Eagles are going to switch it up here. Ferguson on the left side now, Pryor on the right side, and they kick it left. They clearly wanted Ferguson to get this one, and he grabs it, and he's going to get it up to the 25, the 30. Cuts it back to the left side, up to the 35-yard line where he's tripped up. And it was clear they wanted to get the ball in Ferguson's hand as
a player's
down. And Not moving. I can't see who it is right now. Doesn't look like he's moving much as the training staff out there to look at him.
The one thing is we hope everything's okay, but they've really had excellent starting field position. They really haven't been pinned too deep tonight as they're being very, very careful.
And that looks like it's Darian Pryor who was looking to give his fellow return man a it looks like it's number three, Darian Pryor, from here. Okay, so Darian Pryor down. He is able to roll over, and he took a shot as he was throwing a block for Ferguson on that one. And here we'll get another look at this. And you see him on the right side there. Gets hit awkwardly. Gets hit in the leg region as well. Coach Fulcher out there talking to him along with the training staff.
You can always tell how much how coaches, especially with the way they come out to the players, and it shows you really how much they care. And that was the one thing when Spraudling came out and his parents were there. Coach Fulcher was there along with Coach Westbrook and stuff. And the one thing she kept saying was, thank you, guys. Thank you for how much that they treat them like they're their own sons. And that's exactly what you see there with Coach Fulcher and now helping them sit up. Because at the end of the day, it's more than about football. It's about education and about becoming a man.
Absolutely. And the thing is when Pryor was down initially, he wasn't moving much. And now you see him moving, not only moving, but getting up, walking under his own power. And that's a good thing, because initially you never know how serious something like that is. But looks to be okay compared to at least what we could have seen happen, especially with the severity of that hit. Darian Pryor able to walk off under his own power for the Eagles.
Good starting field position yet once again under 35. And then he started taking advantage of some of this field position as
And here we go. Braden Wammeldorf back in. So no TJ Jamison, who got the start today at quarterback. Wammeldorf, who had a big first down run before he lost the football in the last drive, back in under center. Sends a man in motion. He's going to keep it left side. Doesn't find much running room. Gets back probably to the line of scrimmage.
The one thing you see there, when Jamison would run the option, Bethel was more about the pitch man and trying to push him back inside. With Wallendorf, it's almost like they expect him to keep that. Like, he's not even going to attempt to pitch it as they were able to pinch down.
Well there, Wallendorf, and you saw it on the replay, he didn't look to pitch it at all. There was no threat of a pitch there.
And you have to wonder if that's something they picked up in film as well.
Yeah, you certainly do. So it'll be 2nd and 10 on the 35-yard line for the Eagles. Wallendorf back under center. Sends a man in motion, and it's going to be another keeper, and it's going to be fumbled as he tried to hand it off on the exchange with Jordan Frost. And here's the thing, is this offense was rolling some, and then you swap it out with a...
No, they're going to say they got it back.
And there we go. All right, so, and look, he goes to hand it off, and it's just...
Timing.
You put a new guy under center. And I'm not sure how they recovered that, by the way. But
I don't know. I was pretty sure they had three Bethel players sitting right there.
Yeah, so good recovery there. Now 3rd and long. And if you're Wammeldorf, you just got to settle down now and do what Jamison was doing, which was...
It's almost like he's trying too hard. He's trying to get too much on one play.
And that's not only on him. That's on Frost, too. But they got to figure it out quick here. Down 20 to nothing in the second quarter. Sends Frost in motion. He's going to drop back to pass. Doesn't have anybody, looks to evade the pressure, and he's going to get brought down for a sack. And he just didn't have any time there. And that's going to bring up 4th and, 22 or so. And they're going to have to punt with Logan Casetos.
Now your defense needs to come up with a stop. Three possessions for this Bethel offense. All three have ended in touchdowns. Your defense has to get a stop, but... The one thing is, this offense, they've had good starting field position all day. They've been able to move the ball, but they got to find a way to finish. And it's going to be interesting to see if they get TJ back in the second half. Or when that hit, it's possible he has to go through concussion protocol before they put him back in that game, the way his head went back.
And he's on the sideline, does have his helmet on, talking to his offensive lineman there as Casetto's on to kick. This one, a much better punt. Got all of this one. And it's going to be bobbled, and Cincinnati Christian pursuing and going to make the tackle at the 28-yard line. So that's a big play there. as they're able to contain that one. And Casetos, after a bad first punt, gets all of that one.
Well, right there, you talk about a dangerous weapon. He's able to flip field. But also very fortunate that ball bounced straight up in his hands as a couple Eagles were down there ready to pounce on it. But big stop coming up for your defense. You can't give up any more points.
And that was Tito Hunter on the return for the Wildcats, unable to find much running room even though he eluded multiple Eagles defenders. Okay, so here we go. It is first and 10 on the 29-yard line. 9:28 to go here in the first half. Jay Horton, the star cornerback for the Eagles, at the bottom of your screen. You see him guarding Jaquizz Upton. Kerry Sellers in the shotgun. Two running backs next to him. Sellers with the handoff up the left side, and that's Davis. And Davis is going to take it all the way up the left side, and it's a foot race. And he's going to get to the 45-yard line. Davis rumbles, stumbles all the way down into Eagles territory, down to the 45-yard line.
But once again, we keep talking about the chunk plays. We're not used to seeing this defense give up. Well, right there's another 30-yard chunk play against this defense. You're just losing contain up front.
Well, I mean, he didn't get touched until he got tackled. So it's easy. Davis has a ton of talent, but he's not getting touched. And here we go again.
9 yards.
Right up the middle. Doesn't get touched until 8 to 10 yards downfield. And David Fulcher can't be happy so far with the rushing defense.
And that's one of the things
that the Eagles have
I'm going to
so
ask
far.
Him about it is how do you change up your defensive philosophy, because something's up front that's not clicking that it usually does.
And here we go. Sellers in the no huddle. He'll be under center. The Wildcats continue to keep the Eagles off balance. Sellers fakes the handoff. He's looking downfield. They're looking end zone. He's got a man in the end zone. And it's going to be dropped, flagged down.
I don't agree with that pass interference call. The DB ran right by him.
We'll take a look at the replay there. Intended for Breon Melvin, number 11. And he had space, and it looked like he just dropped it. Let's take a look at this.
Ran right by him.
And it's going to be pass interference.
I don't think he touched him. He put the brakes on and he ran right by him. That's just an unfortunate call.
And let's take a look at the replay here. And Sellers looks up the left side.
Now watch him put the brakes on.
I don't know, man.
That's kind of touchy.
That's a little. It looks like the wide
receiver
still
hit him in the hands. He just dropped the ball.
I mean,
you shouldn't get rewarded for dropping a football. You got to catch that football. Sorry.
Yeah. I mean, if that's where it was, if it was in the end zone, that they put it down to the so it'd be first and 10 after the pass interference call on the 17-yard line. Handoff up the middle, and Davis rumbles, stumbles, bumbles into the end zone. And so far, here's the thing, is Davis is tough to bring down. And if you're not touching him until it's 10 yards downfield, he's already got a head of steam. And that's all. It's going to be all she wrote. And let's watch this. I mean, look, just a huge hole. And no one is even touching him. He's not even getting hit till he's in the end zone.
I mean, those are holes even you could run through at this point in
even
time.
Even me. I mean, the truck in the back is running through those holes. I mean, with no gasoline. I mean, this thing, it's getting bad quick. And there you go. There's the extra point. It'll be 27-0. And I'm kind of –
used to seeing this from the CCU defense, no, giving up these chunk plays.
And the Eagles struggled against the run last week, but I'm not. I expected them to be ready, and I don't know if it's a mixture of being shorthanded on the defensive line while also dealing with a Bethel offense that clearly wants to run the ball and knows exactly how to put Davis in position to succeed.
They also come in the second-best rushing team in the country. They do run for 344 yards a game, but that also came up against – teams with the combined two wins through all four games, four teams, two wins.
And here's Davis just straight up the middle. Gets touched a little bit there, but he's 6'2", 235. You're going to have to be physical with him and hit him with multiple guys to bring him down. And so far, I'm not sure if he's really gotten touched much today.
Well, he's getting touched 10 yards down the field.
Not many grass stains on those on those pants so far, as Ty Davis has two touchdowns. And Bethel Wildcats have a 27-0 lead here.
We looked at this
with 8:30 to go in the second half.
When we looked at this at the top, this is a great matchup for CCU.
Yeah.
A team that for the most part has stopped the run. They don't give up big pass plays. One of the best pass defense teams in the country is CCU. They matched up well. A team that doesn't throw it very well. You got a shutdown corner and Jay Horton on one side. A team that gives up a lot of yards rushing. A team that likes to rush the ball. And Coach Fulcher was excited about this matchup, but Bethel just came out. They just punched him in the mouth early, getting 20, 30-yard chunk plays on the ground. And I don't think Coach Fulcher was expecting that part of the game.
And I think the no huddle really threw that defense for a loop so far. And here we go, and it's going to be a pooch punt, or a pooch kick, and that's a heads-up play there by the Eagles to come up, grab it, and that was number 88. Mason Chapman, the freshman tight end, comes up, grabs it. And I don't know.
They were kicking from the 20 as it is because of the unsportsmanlike conduct penalty, but why would you pooch kick it there? Excellent starting field position. You're starting on the right side of the field at the 49. That's a very kind of perplexing. Like, I get the, you know, if you want a high, shorter kick, but to run a pooch and you already kick it from the 20, I don't get that.
Well, and part of it might be Logan Wheat, the freshman punter, in instead of the junior kicker Casey Camerzell today. And that's the big thing here. It's TJ Jamison back under center. And a handoff right side, and that's Garner Harris. And he's going to fall forward up to the down to the 44-yard line. And just like that,
5 yards.
If you're the Eagles, you got to get a score here, and you have your quarterback who was driving you downfield multiple times back under center. Here's a big drive for the Eagles.
But you see the
defense.
8 minutes
to go here in the first half.
The defense respecting TJ's legs and his decision-making because they know he'll take that ball, he'll pull the ball out, take it to the edge. So they have to respect the dive and the option as well.
And here we go. TJ under center again. Hollyfield split out to the bottom of your screen on the left. Three running backs in the backfield. He sends Jordan Frost in motion. It's going to be another handoff to Garner Harris. He gets hit in the backfield, spins forward, and picks up some yardage even though he got hit right away.
That's a
strong piece of running from number 34, Garner Harris.
But third down three. It's four down territory, especially given the score. So you keep your whole offensive playbook open. You got the leg of TJ. Maybe you give him a run pass option along the right side. Let him roll out to his right.
And number 63, Cody Clark, hit Harris right there, right at the beginning. Still able to spin away and get a positive gain. Now third and three as the clock approaches 7 minutes to go here in the first half. Huge third down here. And I wonder if it is four down territory for the Eagles.
It has to be.
Here we go. Jamison under center takes the snap. He's going to keep it. And it looks like he's going to get it down to the 41-yard line.
A
pickup of about one, maybe 1.5 yards. And it's going to bring up fourth down as they need to get to the 39-yard line.
I was kind of surprised they didn't let him go option, straight option on that. Give him a choice. Do you pitch it or turn it upfield? Put the pressure on the defense. Make them make a decision. Do I go for the quarterback or do I go for the running back and put them on a one-on-one spot? Make them make the decision. And you have to believe that's what they're going to do here. Get TJ on the edge. Let him be the athlete that he is and try to make a play.
All right, and here we go. Fourth down. The Wildcats defense scrambling. CCU motions out their receiver, and they're going to throw it. And Hollyfield climbs the ladder with a huge grab. Flag on the play. Couldn't imagine it's against CCU there. I think it'll be against the Wildcats. And what I've seen so far today is the Eagles trust Marcus Hollyfield in big moments. They've went to him on multiple third downs, and they convert there on a huge fourth down.
What I like is they're trusting TJ to throw the football. You're getting all these teams putting 8-9 in the box against this CCU team.
And it's going to be a face mask against the Wildcats. And that's going to advance the ball even farther. And here we go. We've got another look here. And Jamison throwing it on the slant. And Hollyfield climbs the ladder, deals with the face mask.
But that's
huge
the third time
play.
He's climbed the ladder to get a ball. But you're getting those people out of the box, and it's really going to add another dynamic to this offense. You've seen TJ throw the ball in pregames and at practice. This kid can throw the football. He's just inexperienced on what to do with his arm. Playing as a freshman, coming out of Lakota East, a team that runs the football 75% of the time, TJ wasn't asked to throw the ball as much. So he's having to learn how to read coverages and throw the football down the field.
There's a timeout on the field. A Bethel player was injured. He looks appears to be getting tended to. And it'll be first and 10, ball on the 17-yard line. So here you go. Jamison comes back in. 6 minutes to go in this first half. Key to this is getting seven, not three. You want to get into the end zone, build some momentum, and let your defense know, hey, we're here for you too. We can put up some points as well.
But how much different does this offense look with TJ back under center?
And Jordan Frost, number four, pumping up the crowd, moving his arms up and down, telling the crowd to get loud here at Betts Memorial Stadium. This is the first trip in the red zone for the Eagles offense. Jamison under center, sends Frost in motion. It's going to be a keeper up the middle, and he's going to get all the way down inside the 10, down to the 8-yard line. And Jamison with a pickup of about 9 yards on first down.
And this is exactly what you saw him do at Lakota East for 4 years. Now you got that second down and one. You got the play action. You got the option. You got the quick kick to Holyfield. You could throw that in the back corner of the end zone. Let Holyfield jump up. He's already shown he can out-jump the DBs. A lot of options here on a second down and one. The whole entire playbook wide open. You got to get, like you said, though, you have to put the ball in the end zone right now.
And there we go, another motion. Holyfield at the bottom of your screen. Jamison sends Ferguson in motion. It's going to be a handoff to Harris.
Kept
no, he's going to keep it. Smart play. And he's going to pick up a first down. And that's a really smart play. Harris got met. He pulled the ball.
Dangerous.
Able to pick up the first down.
But he made a decision and he stuck with it. But you're going to see if they pull up that replay how far that ball was in his belly when he pulls it back, keeps it himself, and gets the first down because the running back was stopped.
And there you go. I mean, Harris
yes.
is hit with the ball.
He wasn't going to get the first down. He was going to lose a yard.
Yeah, and he's able to still pull it out. He still has his hands in there. As long as you're strong with
yep.
the ball, you can get away with it. Jamison was there. And now CCU at the 5-yard line.
But now you
see the chance to go, chance to score. Holyfield at the bottom of your screen. We'll see if they look to him. And it's going to be, and there we go, a bootleg up the right side, and he's going to score. TJ Jamison in for a CCU touchdown as he goes to celebrate with his teammates. And CCU on the board here at Beth Memorial Stadium with 4:25 to go in the first half. And that's just a great play call. Wildcats weren't ready for it on the 5-yard line. And as we see this replay, Jamison clearly poised,
yep.
knew the call.
He's getting confidence as he's going, and this offense is getting more confident as well. You see how much it opens up. Bethel has to respect all three aspects of that option.
And you see Jamison there. Everything went to the left side.
Yep.
He went right.
The naked
the Wildcats
bootleg.
Were unable to defend that. No defenders in the area. And just like that, with the extra point from Seth Mayer, and just like that, it's 27-7.
Now
the Eagles offense building
yep.
a little momentum, a flag down.
But now you need to get a stop on this defense, get the ball back to your offense. You still have two timeouts and plenty of time, and they're going to get running into the kicker, and that'll be back on the kickoff. So that'll push the kickoff forward 5 yards, just the running variety.
And we see the touchdown run from another angle again. All right, so here we go, 4:25 to go.
That was huge.
A huge play here, and you are listening and watching to Cincinnati Christian Football here at CCUathletics.com, Waycross Television. He's Rob Roberts. I'm James Rapine. We're live here at Betts Memorial Stadium.
Also the home of the Highlanders.
Yeah. he's the voice of the Highlanders. He's got to give Oak Hills a shout-out here. As
hey, Coach Prosser, doing good things.
27-7 now. Eagles able to get on the board. And now you want to keep this momentum
yep.
going. Big stop. The defense hasn't been able to get off the field all half.
But
gonna have
you
to.
See the offense do that, and then that's going to give you a chance.
Going to have to here. They're going to have to here with 4:25 to go in the first half.
Actually, he said running into the kicker, but they just marked it off as a personal foul. Do you try the onside kick here? It's at midfield already.
We'll see. Seth Mayer, and he's going to boot it downfield. Up in the air, and we'll see if we even get a return. And they're not. They're
smart play.
Be a touchback. Yeah, absolutely.
I thought if they didn't try the onside, you do one of those where you just do the high pooch where it lands around the 10-5 yard line. You kick it high enough. You're starting to see that in the NFL a little bit because the way they do the kickoff. Give your coverage team a chance to get down there as well. Kick it inside the five.
It's a good idea. I think Fulcher's probably like, let's give it on the 20. Make him go 80 yards with 4 minutes to go.
That's
he's
probably
just, what he's
thinking. That's just old school football thinking. This is new school sabermetrics football.
Oh, man. Breaking out the analytics here. So to be at the 25-yard line, new rule, by the way, that the last couple years where it now goes to the 25 versus the 20-yard line here in college. So Kerry Sellers going to get a chance here to put on
how about
some
this?
More points up for the Wildcats.
Three wide now. For Bethel, first time we've seen that tonight. Pass snap.
Low snap. Sellers picks
Smart
it up.
Play.
Picks it up, and instead of looking to throw or make a play with his legs, sits on
hey.
It. And that, and
4-0. Fall down. That's a smart play by an upperclassman right there.
And the senior quarterback decided to fall on that one. Not a loss of about 6 yards. It put him on the second and 16 on the 19-yard line. They'll operate out of the shotgun. Four wide receivers. He's looking to throw it again, looking left side.
Got to get there.
Doesn't have anybody. Finds his man right side.
Dropped it.
And that was number 14, Vonta Owens. Caught a touchdown today. Drops that one. Took his eyes off the ball. And that's a third and 16. As you see, David Fulcher screaming. He's upset at something.
Well, that's once again that tight end's been able to leak out.
Yeah. And you see there, Owens just looks away. And
big third down.
Huge third down. Third and 16 here. CCU defense.
Got to watch the screen and watch the draw.
Seller sends a man in motion. He's in the shotgun. Looks to pass again.
Under pressure.
Evades the rush. He's looking downfield. He's going to throw it downfield. That was intended for his tight end, Vonta Owens, again. And it'll be incomplete. Looked like it could be an interception. There is a penalty down in the backfield.
It should have been offensive pass interference as he grabbed the DB and pulled it toward him. But now we're going to get unsportsmanlike conduct against CCU. I don't know. He had to have said a magic word or something. But that's going to be an automatic first down.
So here you see Sellers.
Fulcher's not happy.
Roll left. And he throws it up the sideline. And I wonder.
I don't know. They threw the unsportsmanlike conduct back at the 19-yard line. It's going to be an automatic first down.
I was watching Sellers to see if there was anything there. I didn't see anything on the replay.
And Fulcher just threw his hands up. And they're talking to number nine. They're talking to number nine right now. So that must be the guilty party. But.
Okay, so it's going to be first down on the 39.
Something happened.
And CCU, just when you think their defense gets a break, they don't. And Sellers, handoff left side. And there you go, a pickup of five for Davis. But they were able to hit him earlier on there. Defense coming up with certainly better on that play than we've seen throughout this game so far.
But right now they're going right back to that hurry up just like that.
And it's still a pickup of six, second and four with the clock approaching 3 minutes to go here in the first half. It's going to be a pitch to Davis right up the middle, and he's going to get hit right away. Gets up to the 42-yard line, but it's going to bring up third and short. But that is a big play, and you watch it. Davis, we haven't seen this all day from the CCU defense. Davis gets hit after a pickup of just a couple yards. And that is, looks like that was number 22. For CCU, which is Michael Williams with a big hit there, the strong safety laying the wood on Davis in third and two now. Huge third down chance here. Third and short, though, very makeable for this Wildcats offense, who hasn't had trouble moving the ball up and down the field all day. We have Kerry Sellers, the senior quarterback, in the shotgun. Multiple wide receivers out, and he's going to pass it. He's looking downfield under pressure, and he's going to get brought down by Cincinnati Christian in a huge sack. Wyatt Jefferson in on the play. Also number 38, Derek Craig. The two linebackers in the backfield in the defense coming up big. And there you go, you see it. Craig and Jefferson getting there, bringing down Sellers. And that's gonna force a Wildcats punt as we approach 2 minutes to go here in the first half. It's a first sack of the day for the Cincinnati Christian defense. It'll also be the first punt of the day for the Wildcats offense. So in the past 8 minutes, the Wildcats have reached a point where they've given the Eagles a bit of momentum entering halftime. The Eagles have first scored on a short field, 50 yards, led by T.J. Jamison, a five-yard bootleg run that put them on the board. Now they get a sack, and it sets up the Eagles with the chance to put more points on the board with 2:23 to go. They'll have one timeout. We'll see if they do look to move the ball down the field on this after this punt. Plenty of time, though, for the Eagles if they want to do so.
Well, that was a defensive stop that this team needed. Unfortunately, the unsportsmanlike conduct extended the drive, but that was a big-time third down play there by that defense.
Logan Wheat on to punt for the Wildcats. Christian Williams back for Cincinnati Christian to receive the punt. and it's a good one. Williams is going to fair catch it at the 30-yard line. So with 2:15 to go, T.J. Jamison and the Eagles offense will trap back on the field. One timeout. They trail the Wildcats 27-7 here. 2:15 to go in the first half. We'll see if they can put something together here, maybe get in field goal range or more. We've seen them move the ball up and down the field. They put it all together last drive with a mix of runs and a couple passes. And one man to watch on the Eagles offense is Marcus Holyfield. Coming up at halftime, you will hear from head coach David Fulcher. Rob Roberts will be with him on the sideline. So here we go. First and 10 on the 31-yard line. Jamison under center. And he's going to hand it off left side. And that's going to be Jared Ferguson. He's going to get twisted down at the 36-yard line. And the coach is on CCU side telling him to hurry up as the clock just approaching 2 minutes. We'll be under 2 minutes by the time they get the next playoff. Holyfield, the wide receiver, number 84 at the top of your screen. And this is going to be a pass, bootleg on the right side, and he's looking downfield, and he's intended for Holyfield. And just a little high there from T.J. Jamison. Clock stops now, 1:50 to go in the half. It'll bring up third and four, third and manageable now for the Eagles offense. They have one more timeout, looking to put some points on the board, points up on the board before halftime. Third and four on the 37. Jamison surveying the defense. He'll be under center. And he's looking to pass, looking on that right side, under pressure, rolls left, and it looks like he's going to keep it, and he is. And he's going to get to the 40-yard line, 40 and a half, and no awareness there to, I think he's just short of the first down. We'll see where they spot it. Looks like he was just short, and we'll watch the replay here.
He's going to be about a half a football short.
And if you're TJ there, you stay in bounds for that extra half second. Instead, he runs out of bounds. I know there were defenders there, but now it's going to bring up fourth and about a half a yard, it looks like, for the Eagles offense. He did make the smart play, though. He did get out of bounds.
Actually,
but if he could have got a first down and gotten out of bounds, that would have been ideal.
They're asking for a measurement. The way they spotted the football, that might be a first down.
From up here, I'm a ways away, Rob, now down on the sideline, it does look like it where they spotted it. And it will be a first down. And I'm surprised at that spot, but if you're an Eagles fan, if you're a member of the Eagles, you'll take it.
Well, the initial spot was short, but when they actually physically spotted the football, they gave him a first down.
All right, so here we go, first and 10. Jamison rolls out to the right side, looking to pass it. Intended for Holyfield, and he throws it right to a defender, and that is picked off. And that's number 20, Noah Carlson. And he gets the interception. That's number 20, Kareem Darrington, the defensive back with the interception. And that's one of those things, you look at it, Rob, Jamison's thrown all day to Holyfield. Hasn't had anyone else that he can really trust. And the Wildcats threw an extra guy on him, and Jamison took the bait.
Well, yeah, that time they just cut underneath that route. They've been getting one-on-one on the corners. He missed a wide-open Holyfield earlier, but that time the linebacker just caught underneath, and Jamison just didn't see him there.
Well, 1:36 to go. Kerry Sellers certainly capable of leading this team into the end zone, only 35 yards away. Under pressure here, he evades the pressure. Eyes still downfield, he's going to run it. He's up the right side to the 30, to the 25. He'll be near a first down, gets out of bounds. Clock stops, 1:26 to go here in the first half. And even though out of bounds clock stopped, they're going to continue that no huddle to keep the Eagles defense off balance. Sellers takes the shotgun snap. It's going to be a handoff up the middle. Davis breaks it up the left side, and he's going to fall forward after getting hit at the 20. Gets down to about the 19-yard line. It'll be a pickup of about 6 yards, and Bethel's going to take their first timeout. They still have two remaining.
Bethel calls their first timeout
And Davis is just so big and physical, able to fall forward another 2 yards after getting hit. Sophomore running back already has 2 touchdowns today. Well, big turn of events right now, Rob, is CCU had all the momentum. That interception puts them in a tough spot, puts their defense in a tough spot after getting a big sack and getting off the field just a couple minutes ago.
Well, they had all the momentum. They got the football right back. The defense was able to get that big third down stop, and just unfortunate. Now, listening into the offensive play, the offensive on the sideline, they're talking about how the Bethel defense is just kind of slow playing them and baiting them into certain situations, and it's just about being smarter and trusting in what you see right now.
So the Wildcats break. It'll be 2nd and 3 on the 19-yard line. 1:14 to go here in the first half. Kerry Sellers has played a nearly flawless first half for the Wildcats, the senior quarterback, mixing in his legs, his arm, and has his Wildcats in position to potentially score again before halftime. Under pressure, evades the rush, gets it out on the right side to his fullback in a spin move there, and he's going to be twisted down to the 9-yard line, and that's Devin Raymer, who's able to bring up a first down, and Bethel will take, no, they're not going to take a timeout here. They're going to run the no huddle. Clock under a minute, 57 seconds to go here as it continues to roll. Sellers getting his players in position. Takes the shotgun snap. He's looking right side. Under pressure again, he's going to roll left, look for a wide receiver. It's batted up, almost intercepted by Cincinnati Christian. Almost got it, and Michael Williams, number 22 there. We've said his name a couple times today. Almost able to get it. And we'll take a look at this. We'll take a look at this replay here. And just he stretches out with one arm, unable to get two hands on it, and brings up. And oh, it's going to be right up the middle, and he's going to get all the way into the end zone. And that's the thing we've seen all day today, and that's Kerry Sellers with the rushing touchdown. And we've talked about his ability to run. We've seen it all day today. The Wildcats have been able consistently to run straight up the middle. Rob, you're going to have to talk to. Talk to Coach Fulcher about that at halftime.
I'm sure that's something he's definitely going to address as a whole, is the lack of push coming from the D-line there. Something we're used to seeing is defensive linemen living in the backfield, but today, give Bethel credit up front. They're winning those battles.
Logan West on with the extra point, 34-7. Bethel with the lead over the Cincinnati Christian Eagles. And that's the thing, is if you, they're not getting the push. But we have seen from the Eagles, they've gotten some pressure on Kerry Sellers recently. The past couple drives, they sacked him once. They've consistently put him on the move. So the defensive line, not existent some at the beginning of this game, but the linebackers in the front seven really able to be a bit more active the past couple drives, I would say, Rob.
But then you also have to worry about how devastating that interception was and to give up that score right before the end of the half, and how that plays out for the second half as well.
35 seconds to go here in the first half. You'll hear Eagles head coach David Fulcher with our Rob Roberts at halftime. Bethel with a 34-7 lead. Darian Pryor will be back for this kick, number 3. We saw him earlier in the game get helped off the field. He got up slowly after he was throwing a block, but he is in the backfield. He will be one of the guys on to return this kickoff as he waits for it at the 15-yard line. The other, Jared Ferguson, and we've seen him today. So we saw one big play so far in the special teams game from the Eagles to start this game. Darian Pryor had a huge return. Eagles unable to get any points out of it. They would need one here with 35 seconds to go to put them in position to score. And it's another pooch punt. This one, Pryor's going to get at the 20, and he's going to get brought down after getting to about the 25. A pooch kick, rather. Said pooch punt. But 29 seconds to go, Rob. I think I think here they might just run it, get it to halftime. What do you think?
Yeah, I think you just take the knee and you get out of here. You go back and you make your second half adjustments. Take first ball, second half, and see what you can do.
And again, we will have David Fulcher here at half with Rob Roberts. He's on the sideline right now waiting for the first half to end. And there is a penalty.
Offsetting penalties for
offsetting unsportsmanlike conduct on both sides. Coach David Fulcher talking to one of his players about that, I believe, that unsportsmanlike. And so they'll offset. The ball will be on the 25-yard line. Couldn't imagine the Eagles do much here besides just run the clock out. We'll see what they do as TJ Jemison will TJ Jemison now under center. Sends a man in motion, and it's going to be a quarterback keeper. Breaks it up the left side, unable to find any room. And the clock ticks here, and it looks like that might be it. And then no timeout signaled from either team. We'll see if they try to run another play. It will be Wildcats ball. When we start the second half, the Eagles did receive it. And they do stop the clock. Nine seconds to go here in the first half. Clock stops, second and nine. And Bethel with a 34-7 lead. And it looks like the Eagles are going to get one more play here, or try to. Clock running now, and that's it. That'll be it for the half, as we've seen a mixture of things so far in this first half. Some good, including the TJ Jemison touchdown, the bootleg up the right side, some bad, the rushing defense and the interception. And you're going to hear Coach David Fulcher with our own Rob Roberts. Let's throw it down now to Rob, who's with Coach Fulcher.
Coach, not the start to the game that you wanted. You fell behind 27-0 early, but you had to be happy with the way your defense responded, or your offense responded there with that late touchdown.
Yeah, you know, we've given them a bunch of stuff, and when you give teams things, they're going to take them, and they're taking advantage of it.
One thing we're not used to seeing from your defense is the big plays, a lot of plays of 20-plus yards. What defensive adjustments do you need to do to put that back in check and get back in this football game?
Well, we just got to defend what we're supposed to defend. Right now, we're not defending it, and we're going to find out some kind of way to stop it.
You have to be happy with the progress of your quarterback, TJ Jemison. When he's in there, your offense has been moving the ball pretty well. Right now, it's just about finishing, but you have to be happy with his decision-making so far, minus the interception.
Yeah, we're just doing things that they're giving us, and we just got to take advantage of all the other opportunities.
All right, good luck in the second half, Coach. Back
Thanks,
up to you, James.
Rob. And yeah, that'll do it for the first half, where the Bethel Wildcats lead the Cincinnati Christian Eagles 34-7. We'll be back with the second half. Rob Roberts, myself, and we'll see what second half adjustments the Eagles make. Second half coming at you in about 18 minutes here on the Waycross Television Network, also on CCUathletics.com. For Rob Roberts, I'm James Athene. We'll be back with the second half shortly. Stadium, third quarter about to start here, 34-7, Cincinnati Christian trailing the Bethel Wildcats. Rob Roberts along with James Erpine joining you for this one on Waycross Television, also CCUathletics.com. It was a mixture of things so far in the first half, Rob. I mean, you saw some positive stuff from Cincinnati Christian. They were able to run the ball effectively. They were able to get on the board. They also weren't able to stop the run on defense, but overall, a mixed bag leads to a 34-7 deficit right now to the number 23rd ranked team in the country.
And leads to a very frustrated head coach, David Fulcher. And I think you could sense that frustration in that interview with him. They're giving up big plays. in the run game defensively. They're not able to finish drives. They've been in position to score points, but only able to get the one touchdown. Then that interception right before the half was really a backbreaker almost. But you can see and feel how frustrated Coach Fulch was at the half, feeling like this game shouldn't be 34-7. He never saw this one coming.
And the Bethel Wildcats will get the ball here to start the second half. And this is going to be a big, big possession for the Eagles defense to see if they can get a stop and get it right. They only forced one Wildcats punt in the first half. They're going to have to do a better job of that this half. So here we go. There's the kick. Seth Mayer on the kick, and that's going to be a touchback. It's going to bounce into the back of the end zone. So good job there by the 6'3 freshman using that big leg of his. And the Wildcats will start out on their own 25-yard line.
Defense needs to come out, preferably get a three and out, but they can't give up any more points. T.J. Jemison in his offense was able to move the ball, got the one touchdown. You feel like they should have got some more points, but it's up to the defense. They can't keep giving up 20, 30 yards a pop and put this offense behind anymore as they're going to be forced to throw the football every down.
Kerry Sellers coming back out there. And actually, no, it is not Kerry Sellers. It is Braxton Baugas who hands the ball off, and that's going to be up the left side. And that's Tay Davis with a pickup of six. So there we go, senior quarterback Kerry Sellers. I don't know if it's temporary or not, but the sophomore Baugas, if I'm saying that name correctly, is on now.
Well, you got the senior, he's getting ready to depart. You got a 27-point lead. Let's get the underclassmen some snaps and some game experience.
It's a second handoff. And this time he's going to get hit, but he's going to bounce it outside. And that's the thing, is Tay Davis.
And they're going to get a late hit out of bounds. He hit him about at the end where you see the red and the black. That's where he hit him, was on that white stripe. And hard to argue with that one. It wasn't a big hit, but he did hit him.
And we'll check out the replay here after this flag, and it is going to be unnecessary roughness because of the late hit. And let's look at it here. And this is the thing with Davis. You can hit him and hit him, hit him. You got to be able to wrap him up. He's so big and physical. Bounces it outside. And that's the thing is you're not sure.
He's 5 yards out of bounds.
He's out of bounds. He's definitely multiple yards out of bounds. So that's not a good start there for the Eagles defense. They give up a first down on the ground. And why not, if you're Bethel, put in a guy like Baugas, the sophomore, when you know that Davis has had such a big day on the ground, you know that you're going to be able to run the ball.
When you're getting him game experience. Sellers is gone after this season.
Baugas takes the shotgun snap, looks to throw. Throws left side, intended for his tight end, Owens, and too high for him. Owens unable to bring it in. He's been very active in the passing game. Vonta Owens has a touchdown on the day, unable to bring that one in. And that's just the sophomore quarterback, as you see there, just throwing it a little high. Owens is open. Eagles get a break there.
But you're still seeing that tight end open out in the flat. We've seen him open about 4 or 5 times on a little flat route.
Shotgun snap, handoff right side, and that's to his fullback, number 34, Devin Raymer. Raymer gets it about 2 yards up to the 40-yard line.
Good tackle there by Shoby.
And there we, and now you do what you wanted to do. You force third and long, and this Eagles defense has a chance to get off the field here.
Against an inexperienced quarterback as well. You got to get off the field, no points. Give TJ and your offense a chance to get back in this football game.
Baugas in the shotgun, has his fullback next to him. He's going to fake it to Raymer. Now he's looking to pass. Under pressure, he's going to pitch it to Raymer on the right side. Raymer makes a man miss. He's going to get a first down and more out the right side all the way down. And he's going to stay in bounds and take it to the house. What a run there by the senior fullback, Devin Raymer. Only 160 pounds, 5'8 senior, bouncing off defenders, eluding tacklers,
but Switzer,
getting all the way to the house.
Switzer has a chance to make that play, and he hits him with the shoulder. You can't tackle a guy with your shoulder. You got to wrap up that ball carrier and bring him down. He tries to hit him with the shoulder. He breaks free, and he's gone to the house. Same problem with Davis. You got to wrap these guys up. You can't tackle them up high. You got to go down low.
And that was just a good piece of running and a bad piece of tackling there from CCU. Bethel University now up with the extra point from Logan Wheat. 41-7 here with 13:28 to go in the third quarter. That's about as bad of a start to the second. David Fulcher didn't envision that when he brought his team back out here from halftime. They did not want it to start that way. And Bethel continues to build momentum and continues to extend their lead over the Eagles.
Well, we talked about the big plays. You get them third and long, third and nine. And instead,
it's just a little screen play.
Yep. Once again, he just slipped out of the backfield. They're not picking up the running back out of the backfield. Easy pitch and catch for the young sophomore quarterback on a third and long. You have to be expecting screens and draws. They hit him on the screen and should have been tackled, but at the end of the day, it's still a big play. And you know Coach Fulcher's not happy at all.
You're watching Eagles football on Waycross Television, also on CCUathletics.com. He's Rob Roberts. I'm James Erpine as we get set here for the kickoff. The Eagles set to get the ball here, and we'll see what they do on offense. We've seen a mixed bag from them. They've been able to move the ball up and down the field. And now if you're the Eagles, this is when you're down by 34 points at home like this, might want to open up the playbook just a little bit. We'll see if that's what they do on this possession.
But it's also about building momentum for next week and the rest of the season as well.
Logan Wheat with the pooch kick again, and we've seen that multiple times today. Eagles with the return gets up to about the 34 yard line, and that's number 39 there. He did that, Ruben Mathis.
Well, you can tell they respect Horton and Ferguson back there. They don't want to give them a chance at that running start. Kick that ball to the up back, give up the field position, but don't let Horton or Ferguson take it to the house.
And the other thing is just having a freshman punter back mm-hmm. there kicking off for you. Certainly something Bethel wants to avoid is any big plays on special teams. So it'll be first and 10 on the 32-yard line. Cincinnati Christian trails 41-7 here. TJ Jemison will be under center. Marcus Holyfield, we've seen him multiple catches today, but the 6-foot freshman at the top of your screen. Jemison sends a man in motion. Hands it off the left side, and that's going to be Garner Harris. He's going to fall forward to the 36-yard line. It's going to be a gain of 4 on first down and bring up second.
But once again, another 4 or 5 yards on first down. They've been playing right along with the chains. Just need to start capitalizing. Just need to start finishing these drives with touchdowns. We saw it there toward the end of the half right before the interception. But this offense has really been able to move the ball up and down the field pretty easy.
And that's the thing is Garner Harris, once he gets moving, he always falls forward for an extra yard. He rarely, after he builds up that steam, rarely falls backward or gets hit backward. And you've seen a mixed bag here from Jared Ferguson, Jordan Frost, and Garner Harris. Three different running backs, different attack here. They're going to be officially 2nd and 5 as he sends Frost in motion. There'll be another handoff to Harris on the right side. It's going to get up to about the 39. They're going to mark it at the 40.
Yep.
One official's got it. I think about the 39.5 yard.
But you're only 3rd and 2. Once again, you're 3rd and manageable. You keep Jamison's legs into it, and you keep the dive, and you keep the option into the outside open as well.
And that's just Harris, as you see him, just moving the pile a little bit, getting it up to the 39. And they're going to officially put it at the 40-yard line. So it'll be 3rd and 2.
But you always run a little bit harder when you got mom in the stands for the first time.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Garner Harris's mom surprised him all the way from Texas for this game today. She is in the stands. Big third down. He sends Jared Ferguson in motion. And he's going to fall forward, but he gets hit by multiple defenders. And there you see Jemison just unable to find a crease. Made the right decision. There's defenders in the area, but looks like it's going to be 4th down. And that means a punt for the Eagles.
But you still have to be happy with the way TJ's progressed. A guy that, when he got demoted, could have gone in the tank. Instead, he stayed in the film room, did what he had to do. So that way, when he got his chance again, he would be more prepared. And I think you're seeing how prepared he is today and running this offense.
All right, so clock approaching 11 minutes to go here in the third quarter. Casetos takes the snap, has the punt, and it's a good one. Up the left side, and it's going to be fair caught at the 16-yard line.
Such a weapon.
So the Wildcats there, they'll get the ball on the fair catch. Number 32, Tito Hunter. Fair catches that one. And, yeah, Logan Casetos, he's one of the best punters for sure. Not only in this conference. No doubt about it.
23rd in NAIA in punts per attempt at 39.6 yards per attempt. not net average. Now we have another quarterback, number seven's now in the game. Or is that two? Let's go seven.
Yeah, it's that's number seven, and that's Nolan Chaube, the sophomore quarterback in the shotgun for the Wildcats. And it looks like that's a false start. And that's interesting. Nolan Chaube now, the 6'1", 175-pound quarterback from sophomore from Mount Juliet, Tennessee. Back him up 5 yards.
Battle of sophomores. That's going to be an interesting battle in camp next year when you're going to have two juniors trying to take over for the departing senior in Sellers.
So it'll be first and 15 on the 11-yard line. Chaube in the shotgun. Takes the snap, handoff right side.
Good play, Jay Horton.
And that was a good play by number six, Jay Horton. Brings down the ball carry after a very minimal gain. And you see there,
Horton's the kind of a guy, I'm surprised, that he doesn't play both offense and defense with his big play capabilities.
Octavian Burrow unable to find much room there, so it's going to bring up second and 13 for Chaube in this Wildcats offense. Takes a snap with one hand looking downfield, and he's going to throw it. He's got his man, and that's going to be a minimal gain on the left side. That's Josh Williams on the catch up to the 20-yard line. They're going to spot it, so it'll be about third and six now for the Wildcats.
But one thing you saw there, once again, they were late rotating over to the fullback coming out of the backfield. But you have them in third and long. You're in that 6 to 7 yard range. Let's see if they can finally get some pressure up front with the front four.
So far, the Eagles have only forced the Wildcats to punt once today. Third and six here. Can they do it again? Sophomore quarterback in the backfield, Chaube, looking to throw. Throwing it up to his fullback, and it's going to be too far out of bounds.
But that time, Chaube actually picked him up as they ran the motion down, forcing the throw long and get the defense off the field.
And that was intended for Josh Williams, and we'll roll the. All right. So the Eagles are going to get the ball back, and Darian Pryor. Let's look at this replay again, and it's just overshoots his fullback there. He's open. That's a tough throw for the sophomore Nolan Chaube to make.
That's from far hash.
Absolutely.
So that's a tough throw for a professional to make.
So here we go. Here's the punt. Up the left side. He didn't
get
much
of that
it.
Flag. He was pushed into the punter. He was pushed from behind. 97 was. And that's his argument. You can't be blocked into the kicker and throw the flag. He was blocked into the kicker.
Penalty marker on the play.
And are they going to call this flag down?
If it's a personal foul, it's an automatic. If it's a running, it's just a 5-yard variety. But he was pushed into the kicker. And it's a 5-yard. They're going to say running into the kicker. But at the end of the day, he was still pushed. Watch the replay here.
The call is running into the kicker, a 5-yard penalty.
Be fourth down and one.
That's going
to
be on number 97, Andrew Alekna, the defensive tackle. We'll see here where they spot it.
They're going to be about a yard short, yard and a half, but they might just take the 5 yards from the end of the run and just not try to. A lot of bad things can happen on the snap. You get the block. Just go ahead and take the 5 yards, push him back 5 yards further, and let CCU keep the football.
And there we go. You see Alekna. And he's building a full head of steam. It's close to tell on that. You definitely see the Wildcats, the guy who's blocking Alekna, have his arms extended. Tough to see, though, whether
or not. I think that might be why he gave him five, because it might have been a combination. He could have pulled up, and he didn't. But yet he was still engaged in his block as well.
Well, the Eagles still their ball on the 50-yard line, first and 10.
But now.
T.J. Jemison.
The wind. Does that go into your play calling with TJ throwing the football as well as it's going from left to right? I mean, it's really picked up here in the last few minutes. And you can see the flagpole in the north end zone.
All right, so the wind, not too bad, but I am surprised they didn't just tack it on at the end and repunt. That wasn't a good punt by any means for the Wildcats. So CCU with a chance here, short field. I mean, you're 50 yards away from scoring. T.J. Jamison in this offense needs to get something going here and score.
I think that decision was just more of it's going to be fourth and a yard and a half. You could have a bad snap. You could have a block. And you don't want that kind of momentum changing hands like that. All of a sudden, it's a 41-14 football game. Your defense, while you've given up a lot of first downs, you've really kept CCU out of the end zone. So go ahead, play that defense. And you're up 41-7 at this point.
All right. So the refs continuing to talk now to both coaches, trying to figure this out. David Fulcher talking with two different officials here. The front judge talking to Fulcher.
Now they want the penalty. But the problem now is you've already moved the down markers.
Can we talk about them? This delay here. Do you think the refs know what's going on?
Well, we won't get into the debacle that was the counting last night of penalty yardage, but without the help of replay at this level, you've already moved the sticks. We know it's going to be a yard and a half short, but did they note where the yardages were at before they moved the chains?
Very interesting. And now the offense going to walk off the field for the Eagles.
So it's going to be fourth down regardless. Re-punt.
Man, that took a long time for those refs to figure out. I mean, is this Seattle-Green Bay a couple years ago with the replacement refs when all that stuff? I mean, it's been 5 minutes now. Let's go. I mean, I'm serious. 9:50 to go here in the third quarter.
Well,
Bethel
I will give them
41-7.
They did get it right. It is fourth down and one. We'll give them that part.
All right, so we're going to get a –
but more bad
another
than good.
Punt. Another punt here. So after all that, we're going to redo it. Christian Williams back for the Eagles.
So
and it's going to be punted.
And it's
going right to
be shorter
side.
Than the 50.
It looked like, yeah, and it goes down, goes out.
Let's see where they officially mark it at. Nobody was watching when the ball went out of bounds. It did not go out of bounds at the 47. It crossed before then.
Let's see where they mark it. Either way, it's going to be a difference of about 2 yards for that replay.
Here we go. Now they're marking it. They're going to leave it at the 47, but that's not where it crossed. But that's a heck of a delay for 3 yards.
Yeah. Well, either way, good opportunity now for the Cincinnati Christian offense to add to their
they've had good
7 points so far. T.J. Jamison. Back out there, and you can watch this punt again and watch it go out right there.
But they've had good starting field position the whole night.
It might be a yard or two difference, but overall, you're 53 yards away. If you're the Eagles offense, you've got to be excited with where you're starting this drive.
They really haven't been disappointed with any of their starting field position tonight.
Jamison sends a man in motion. He's going to keep it. He's going to fall forward. They're going to mark it up to the 50-yard line. It'll bring up 2nd and 7 for Cincinnati Christian.
But once again, that 3 to 4 yards on first down, you stay ahead of the chains, and you're able to keep that playbook open. I did think, though, in the second half that we would see more TJ vertically down the football field than we have. I know you want to stay with the offense, get the momentum, get this timing down as you move out for your last four games, but you still like to see that vertical threat. We saw Holyfield able to get up and get some, and TJ been making good decisions down the football field. I thought we maybe see a little bit more vertical than we have.
Still plenty of time to open up that playbook. And we'll see here what the call is.
23 jumped, 74 jumped, 84 jumped.
And it is going to be a false start. That'll back up the Eagles 5 yards to bring up 2nd and 12 now. From their 45-yard line.
Those mental mistakes, and that's what Coach Fulcher is going to harp on throughout the week. When they go back and they watch films, you take notes, and you get ready for next week. Three straight road games coming up with the start of next week, and you can't have mental mistakes like that, especially on the road. What went from a 2nd and 7, now all of a sudden you're back at 2nd and 12. Now you're behind those chains yet once again.
So 2nd and 12, as Rob alluded to, 8:58 to go here in the third quarter. And T.J. Jamison handed it off to Garner Harris, and that is going to get hit in the backfield. That'll be marked at the 42-yard line, so it'll be backed up even more now for this third down.
And you're going to see here, it really doesn't matter when he hands it off. Even if he keeps it, look at the Bethel players. They already got their hands on TJ as well.
Yep.
That's good defensive pressure up front by the Wildcats.
And I think what they did there is TJ realized even if he kept it, it wasn't going to matter, so he just let it go. Let Garner carry it.
Smart play.
All right, so third and long, Jamison under center. Third and 15, clock approaching 8 minutes. He's going to throw it. Play action, unable to break the tackle there as 51 was in pursuit. And that's just a tough play to make. Jeremy Johnson on the stop for the Wildcats. And there you go. We're going to see another punt. You can see right away getting through that line and bringing down Jamison right there. He didn't really have a chance on that play.
Well, that's about the third or fourth time we've said his name in the backfield, big old 51. Second time he's sacked Jamison for a loss. Pretty quick for a big guy. I mean, TJ can run the football, and for a big 252-pounder, he runs really well.
Logan Cassetto's on to punt, and it is blocked, and the Wildcats are going to recover it at the 25-yard line. And that isn't the first time we've seen a block this season. And Cassetto's unable to get that ball off. And we'll see who missed it. It was on the right side who blocked it, one of the Wildcats, as we look at this. Take a look at it in a second here.
But that's the one thing, and even Coach Fulcher had harped on the first few weeks, is sometimes Logan can hold that ball for an extra second, and that's all it takes for that defender to get up there. And that time he was able to get the block.
That's Christopher Burney, the freshman wide receiver, coming in on the right side for the Wildcats, making a huge play and giving quarterback Braxton Baugus, who's back there now, as they've rotated quarterbacks so far. Second time we've seen Baugus in this second half, has a chance to put more points on the board for the Wildcats. And it's a handoff up the middle. And that's going to get to the 14-yard line, number 29, Octavian Burrell, on the carry, and that's going to bring up, a first down. Yeah, they're going to move the chains here. It's going to be good enough.
You talked about the whole first half. He's getting 10 yards down the field. Michael Marble makes a tackle, but that's your safety. That's your third level that's making your tackles, making first contact.
Baugus with a handoff again, left side, and he's going to take it down to about the 5-yard line, and that's Zach Winston, the freshman running back, and you're seeing different running backs, different faces in now. You have to wonder if Tay Davis, if that's it for the sophomore star running back for the Wildcats, as they've started to put in some freshmen and some guys we're just seeing for the first time today, as you see him run up the left side there, and it's good enough for a gain of 5. Baugus under center now, 2nd and 5. It's going to be a pitch to the right side to the freshman, he's going to get brought down at the 7-yard line. Zach Winston struggling to find room on that one.
That's the first time we've seen that defensive line be able to get into the backfield. And now we have a player down about the 2-yard line. Looks like Marble.
It's just a big, big hit there from the Cincinnati Christian defense.
Marble starting strong safety, finally able to get up. Hopefully just little cobwebs.
Number 22, Michael Williams, jogging onto the field to take Marble's place.
And we've seen him as a guy Bethel was picking on a little bit there toward late the first half. CCU called a timeout to make that defensive change in the backfield.
Just over 6 minutes to go here in the third quarter. Bethel threatening again. It's 3rd and 4 on the 8-yard line. Cincinnati Christian really trying their defense, really trying to solve this Bethel offense, unable to so far today. And it'll be a play action and a huge hit. And it's going to be recovered, but man, Leslin Switzer came in and delivered the boom there to force the fumble. What a play by number 9. Boom.
Came on that the outside linebacker blitz off the edge. We said Switzer's name a few times. This time he was able to get there. Big hit. And now another third down, fourth down. And they're going to keep the offense out there.
Leslie Switzer delivering the wood. The linebacker coming in. And they got to get down to the 4-yard line for a first down. And he's looking. And Switzer again.
Lucky that wasn't picked
with
off.
The pass batted. And just like that, two huge plays by Switzer. And Cincinnati Christian is going to get the ball back at their own, it looks like, 21-yard line.
And Switzer should have had this one. I think that's one he'd like to have back. Hit him in the hands, and that would have been interesting to see if he could have scored on that. But the defense has had their problems, but Switzer's had himself a heck of a football game here today.
He has, and two big plays, and you really wonder what Braxton Baugus, the sophomore quarterback for the Wildcats, was seeing on that one. Hey, Switzer was in plain sight. And here's a hit, the forced fumble again that set that up. Boom. Switzer forces the fumble. The Wildcats did recover. But that set up a fourth and long, which has led to Cincinnati Christian getting the ball back now. First and 10 on the 22. TJ Jemison sends a man in motion. And it's going to be a pitch to Jordan Frost on the right side. He's got some room, makes a cut, gets up to the 28, 29-yard line before it being brought down. A pickup of 7, and it'll set up second and 3 now for the Eagles.
That was the best pitch Jemison's had. We talked about some of his high ones, including the forward one to Harris back in the first quarter. That time delivered a nice pitch, hit him right in the hands, able to turn forward. But you talk about that hit by Switzer, how does that affect him moving forward? You know, quarterbacks, sometimes they get a little gunshot. They take that big hit coming off the edge. Does that affect him moving forward as well?
And there you see the pitch, and Frost has some open room, makes that cutback, able to get 7 yards on first down. And it's going to be a handoff up the middle now. And that looks like it's Garner Harris. Looks like he's going to get it up to the 30-yard line. It'll bring up third and 2 for the Eagles as they try to put together some first downs here and try to march downfield.
Hey, it's but once again, you're in that third down, 2 to go. And that quick belly dive. And really, that's the first time they've really bottled up Davis on that quick hitter like that. He's been able to fall forward, get his 2-3 yards at you, as you had mentioned earlier.
So here we go, 3rd and 2, ball on the 30. TJ Jemison calling out some orders to his teammates now as he's under center. And he's going to look to throw it. Doesn't have a man, rolls out to the right. Still looking. Tries to find someone, but there's a flag down. And we'll see what that call is.
I know Frost is not happy. He was jumping up and down. If TJ just would have been able to look to his left, it was Frost, nobody else, and he could have walked into the end zone.
Tight end Matthew Fryer, very upset, number 23. And it is going to be holding. So, yeah, he was very upset about it. It's going to that will be a first down. That's going to advance the ball for the Eagles. So a big play there.
But TJ's legs were able to keep that play going, helped draw that penalty. You saw the tight end trying to get to the sideline to be able to pick that up. But that's one of the things when you have an athletic quarterback like TJ, able to keep plays extended, and you're able to pick up a first down. A first down this offense really needed. Give that defense a couple extra minutes.
So now it'll be 1st and 10 on the 40-yard line. 3:34 to go here in the third quarter. Jemison and the rest of the offense breaks the huddle. Marcus Holyfield at the top of your screen. Three running backs in the backfield. Frost in motion, or it's actually Ferguson in motion. He's going to keep it. He can't pitch it to Ferguson because there was a defender in the area. He's going to be brought down on the sidelines. And no flag thrown. Cincinnati Christian wanted one for a late hit since he was out of bounds. It's not going to happen, though. And let's take a look at this replay.
I think it had to do the
He's
way he was tackled
him,
at the
riding
end.
Him, riding him, riding him. Yeah. Yeah, it looked pretty clean to me. I understand the late, how he was brought down at the end, but he was still in bounds when that started.
That's
so.
What Folger's talking about.
So that'll bring up 2nd and 10 on the 40.
TJX for a new play clock. That's what he got, hence the official putting his hand in the air.
All right, so TJ Jamison under center. Two wide receivers out. He's got the tight end at the bottom of your screen. Hollyfield at the top of your screen. He's going to hand it up left side. Garner Harris, unable to find much running room, maybe a yard or so up to the 41-yard line, and that's about it. So it's going to bring up third and long.
See if they do the same rollout to the right with TJ this time, giving him that run pass option as they tried to on the previous third down. This time, though, you're looking at third and nine, not a third and two.
All right, so big third down here. Definitely a throwing down. He's got one wide receiver split out. It's his go-to guy, Marcus Hollyfield.
Play clock's already down to seven.
TJ Jamison sends his tight end in motion. Three running backs in the backfield. Play clock at three. Hikes it, looks to the right side. He's looking across, and he's looking downfield for Jordan Frost. Unable to get it to him. There's double coverage there. Two Wildcats in the area. And it looks like a CCU offensive lineman slow to get up. He's going to. That's number 78, Jake Slager, who was down for a second, now trotting off the field. And that's going to bring on fourth and 10, and we'll bring up another Eagles punt.
They got him listed at 295. He's every piece of that. But the one thing you liked about the throw there, even though it was in double coverage, he threw it far enough to where either Frost was going to catch it or nobody was going to catch it. Didn't force the ball into that tight window as nobody else was open in the route.
Here we go. Logan Cassetto's on to punt, and he got hit, and there's going to be a flag on that one, and it's fair caught, but Cassetto's got hit on that one, and you can see the flag down, so this could be good news. We'll see what the call is.
They're just going to give him the 5 yard running into the kicker.
And there we go, and you see it right there. Number 19 comes across his body. That's Christopher Burney. The guy who blocked the last one gets a penalty on this one. He was clearly hungry to get another block punt. Didn't happen on that one.
But that's a good call. That's exactly what a running the kicker is. He stuck his arm out, smacked him across his chest, pulled him down, and they're going to make him punt. And CCU's deciding to take the five and punt it again and see if Logan can't really put his foot into one, as the original one was right around the 23-yard line.
Clock stopped now with 1:51 to go in the third quarter. Bethel with a 41-7 lead over Cincinnati Christian.
But this also sets up, you get another running into the kicker, or you get a defensive offside. It's going to turn into a first down as it's fourth and four now.
All right, so here we go. Cassetos. He takes it. Clean punt. And he's going to drill this one, and it is going to bounce. It's going to bounce. Oh, and it just trickles into the end zone. And that was close to being downed by number 81, Daquan Bowman. Just steps away from doing that, and that'll put the ball at the 25-yard line as it just trickles into the end zone. The 20-yard line, rather, on a touchback on the punt.
I'm not a big fan of special teams and watching kickers.
Yeah.
Just not a fun part of the game. But when you can see somebody punt the ball or kick the ball the way Logan does, it does make it fun to watch. I mean, that guy can get after it.
So it's going to bring up first and 10. And again, we're seeing the rotation of quarterbacks. Nolan Chalbe back out there, his second series of this quarter. And he's going to flip it up the left side. And that's going to be a pickup of about 4 yards or so.
Marbles in there.
And that was number 38, Logan Diebold, the fullback on the carry there. And here we go. It's going to be no huddle. So even though the senior quarterback, Kerry Sellers, isn't in there, Chalbe is still running the no huddle. He's going to take the snap. It is a pass. Looking downfield. Throws right. He's got a man, and he's got it. That's number 83, Blake Lee, and the sophomore wide receiver. And that's over Jay Horton.
And usually you don't see Horton overplay a ball like that. Usually Jay Horton's going to pick that one off or at least knock it away. And this thing is coming back, and it is. It's going to be a legal procedure on the offense, so it doesn't matter. But kind of surprised to see Jay Horton. We've been able to watch him now three times. Usually pretty solid, especially on a jump ball like that.
He was in position, and then you saw on the replay he ended up behind the receiver there. But a legal procedure, so it will negate that play, and the Eagles get a break on that one.
You almost have to wonder if that ball, both how high it was, if maybe the wind affected a little bit, and that's why you saw Jay overrun it by just about a yard.
So it's going to bring up second down here on the 19-yard line. Chaube under center. And he's going to, it's a play action. He's rolling out to the left side, and he's got a man downfield, and it's complete. All the way up the left side is tight end down to the 40, down to the 35, and that's number 86, and he's going to take it all the way. Marvin Rudd all the way and missed tackles, and that's got to be so frustrating for this defense and for Coach Fulcher, because even after you give up the play there, there's got to be someone to make the tackle. Instead, 86, Marvin Rudd gets into the end zone, and we're going to see the replay here. Great rollout by Chaube. Good throw on the run. Accurate. And it's his tight end in position to run. But look at the Eagles in the area. They're in the area, and one got blocked, but unable to get him down. And now Bethel takes a 48-0 lead after that extra point with 39 seconds to go here in the third quarter.
The one thing that was impressive about that is when he rolled to his left, he's thrown across his body, able still to get a lot of zip on it. Nice tight spiral, hit his guy in stride. That's an impressive throw for the young sophomore. And then, as you said, just not very good tackling down the field led to that touchdown, which should have been about a 30-yard gain, turned into an 80-yard touchdown.
And what it was is Marvin Rudd, the touchdown there, made Shane Quise behind. Shaquise Behanan, rather. Sorry, my eyes failed me on that one. But Behanan just missed in the open field. And you miss like that in the open field, and they're going to make you pay. And the 23rd-ranked Bethel Wildcats now extend their lead up 48-7.
But if you got a young player that can throw like that across his body on the run, you have to be excited by your future if you're a Bethel coaching staff as well.
Yeah, that was a good throw there by Nolan Chaube. No doubt about that one. So we'll see Logan Wheat, the freshman punter, kicking today for the Wildcats. Their normal kicker, Casey Camerzell, out, and we've seen the pooch kicks so far today a lot of times from Wheat. We'll see if they do it again here. I would expect them to do the same thing, so let's see what Wheat does. And he's going to do that again, and it's going to be picked up at the 35-yard line, and Darian Pryor is going to get taken down at about the 39 or so. So gets it upfield, and another good starting field position. Yeah, it's not like they haven't had good field position today to start. In
some of the previous games we've seen where they've started a lot of drives inside the 10, the 15, and that range. Today, we're starting field position right at the 35-yard line.
And if you look, Braden Wommeldorf on the field now. It isn't T.J. Jemison. Wommeldorf getting some snaps and starting this drive. And Wommeldorf's going to take it up the left side, get to the 44-yard line.
But there you saw when they came out, he had a chance to pitch it. He doesn't even look at his pitch man to even make the pitch. As you'll see here, he doesn't even, as he comes out, doesn't even make eye contact. He's got a man to pitch it to in Ferguson. He's looking straight up the field. He's just going to turn it and run. And I think you see when he came in when TJ got hurt, the defense just collapsed on the quarterback because they know he's not going to pitch.
And that is going to be the end of the quarter. Well, right now, the Bethel Wildcats lead 48-7 over the Cincinnati Christian Eagles. You're listening to Eagles football right here on Waycross TV and Cincinnati Christian University Athletics.com. And Rob, we look at this game, one quarter to go. We know Wommeldorf has the arm. We know TJ Jemison has the arm. No matter who's under center, I expect the playbook to open up maybe a little bit because you're building. And Coach Fulcher's talked about it. I think they maybe take shots downfield, whether it's tricks, anything like that, to kind of get this offense going, build some confidence heading into next week.
Well, and the offensive coordinator, Mr. Johnson, you have to wonder if he's going to start taking those shots, maybe use some of those seam routes. We've seen the receivers be able to go downfield and make some plays. We've seen Payne make a couple catches. We've seen Holbrook make a couple plays. Do you give them more chances now down the field? Eventually, these quarterbacks got to learn how to use their arm and how to get that ball down the field. We've both seen the arm strength. Now they have to start trusting their eyes and delivering that football.
So second and five as we start the fourth quarter here. As you're watching the Cincinnati Christian Eagles football, it's their third of four home games on this season. He's Rob Roberts. I'm James Rapine. And you're watching Waycross Television and CCUAthletics.com. So second and five on the 44.
Big three-game road trip coming up as well.
And it's going to be Womeldorf under center. And it's going to be a handoff in a reverse to Frost, and he's going to break it up the right side. He's at the 40. He's at the 30. He makes a man miss and gets brought down at the 25-yard line. Jordan Frost and the trickery works there on the reverse, and the Eagles get down to the 25. And a huge play to start the fourth quarter for Cincinnati Christian.
Well, remember the first time they tried that early in the football game in the first quarter, they fumbled that play. This time they're able to execute and get Frost in the open field, able to make a couple guys miss before he's finally thrown down to 25. Huge gain, and you'd like to see him capitalize here, get some more points on the board as they start building for a big three-game road trip coming up.
So first and 10 on the 25. Huge run by Frost on the reverse. Three running backs in the backfield. Hollyfield back, and it's going to be a handoff up the middle to Garner Harris, and he's going to fall forward to the 22-yard line. A pickup of three on first down.
Once again, you see Garner falling forward, able to get that 3 yards, keeping that second down and seven
Garner
range to
Harris
go.
Picks up three on carry.
Braden Womeldorf under center, second and five, and it's going to be a handoff to Ferguson, and he's going to get hit in the backfield right away.
That's it.
Number 92, Eric Hicks there with the bringing down Ferguson, and that's going to be a tough, big loss, about 4 yard loss now for the Eagles, and they're going to face third and long.
And now you're behind the chains again. Now all of a sudden you're third down 11 and in a 12 yard range. Really forcing your hand defense. They kind of drop back in that nickel, and all of a sudden it makes your quarterback's job even a little bit more difficult. As now you see a lot more Fryer, a little less pain here in the second half.
And Womeldorf's going to roll out to the left side, and he's going to keep it. He makes one man miss, and he's got it tucked, and he's cutting up the right side. He's at the 10, one man to beat, stiff arm, and he's down to the 3 yard line, loses the ball at the end of the run.
Slow to get up.
Got brought down hard, but he is up and moving. And let's watch this replay. He's boot to the left side, gets turned, gets his hips turned, realizes no one's open, tucks it, which we didn't see him do earlier in the game, and able to get all the way down inside the 10, inside the 5.
But how about the blitz?
Placing it at the 4 yard line.
How about the blitz pickup on the far side? But Garner Harris able to seal that, allowed Womeldorf to step up in the pocket, which led to that long run. Good blitz pickup there by the fullback.
Inside the 5 now, first and 10. It's a handoff to Harris, and he gets met with a wall, breaks it outside, and gets hit by multiple defenders.
As soon as he grabbed the ball, what's Mama do? Mama stands up. She was ready.
Garner Harris's mom flew in from Texas to watch her son play this weekend. Hadn't seen him since camp began in August. And how special would that be? How special would that be if he was somehow able to find the end zone as he trots off the field?
Make that flight back to Houston a lot easier, a lot more pleasant.
So we got 11:50 to go here in the fourth quarter as the clock continues to run.
They're trying to reset the play clock. That's what the officials are asking for. Now they finally do it.
Under center. And he's going to throw it. And he's looking. Doesn't have anybody. Makes a man miss. Makes another one miss. And he's going to try to run it again. And he's going to get there.
Late
into
flag.
The end zone. A
Ferguson.
Flag thrown. And I think they're going to say Brock in the back. That's what it looked like.
They'll get Ferguson, number five. Right when he crossed the goal line, they're going to get him. They're going to get the hole, but it's still going to be on Ferguson. Unfortunately, right there in front of the side judge.
And you'll see it. So Wommeldorf makes a man miss.
Right there. He let go too late.
And that's going to negate a touchdown there. Wommeldorf with a good piece of running. But and that's going to back him up even more all the way to the 11-yard line now.
And you see him get a little gunshot the closer we get to the end. It looked like he might have a receiver out in the flat. Instead of wanting to take that chance, he just tucked the ball and ran.
Number two, Chris Young in the backfield. Wommeldorf again under center. Jared Ferguson on his right side. Hollyfield, the wide receiver, at the bottom of your screen. And he's looking for Hollyfield under pressure. Wommeldorf makes a man miss, but that's it.
That's good defensive pressure there. Once again, though, up front, Big 13 was able to get in the backfield.
And if you're Wommeldorf here, you make the first guy miss, you need to throw it away. He likes to make plays happen with his legs, and I know he's a freshman. But you get outside that tackle box and get it out of bounds. Instead, they back up even more. Now they're on the 24-yard line.
Trayvon Brown, the junior defensive lineman, able to get back there. You have to believe this is four-down territory.
We went from a touchdown to third and
to a timeout.
And forever.
But you have to wonder, depending on what you get here, do you go ahead and go for it on fourth down, or do you run your special teams out there and work on your field goal unit?
I mean, I wouldn't be against either one if you're the Eagles. It's just in two plays it went from a touchdown and that block in the back by Ferguson. What a killer there, because I'm not sure the defender even gets to Wommeldorf. It didn't look like he would have. Looked like he was going to walk in anyways, and I think we're going to dial up that replay.
Yeah, just an unfortunate, just wrong place at the wrong time. He just would have let go a half a second sooner. Might not have got the flag, but you see the defender come straight across from him, and you'll see the hole.
And you'll see
it.
So Wommeldorf, using his legs, as we've seen multiple times today, makes the defender miss, and he's going to go all the way, and it's right at the end, right there. Ferguson with the push, and you see the flag thrown. Cost the Eagles six, and now after that, the penalty backed him up, and then a sack. And just like that, it's third and a mile to go as the Eagles have taken a timeout.
The one thing you're going to see them work with while I'm both moving forward, and even there, you see how loose that football was when he was running? You had about a six-inch gap from his waist to the football with his bare hands on it. He fumbled it earlier on a huge run, almost fumbled it again.
So 10:43 to go in this one. Bethel leads 48-7. Wildcats had a touchdown negated a few plays ago. Now they're all the way back at the 24-yard line. And they are going to throw it, but pressure instantly on Wommeldorf. And I don't know what he's going to do. He's going to roll out right. Throws it downfield. And Hollyfield with a huge grab. What a play. But what a play. And that is... Man, oh man, Braden Wommeldorf rolling out with multiple defenders in his face, finds his wide receiver, Marcus Hollyfield, and they're going to show this replay, and look at this, finds him downfield, and boom, what a catch, and we've seen that from number 84 multiple times today. Number 61, Trevor Glasgow, was down on that play. He did walk off the field.
So is Hollyfield. Looks like he got the wind knocked out of him. He's talking to Fultz right now, trying to catch his breath. You saw at the end of that the way he landed on his back, but
I mean, he got up and slammed the ball. He was excited. I think he'll be fine. I think what a play there, and now it brings out fourth and manageable. And you're right, you get to work on your kicking, your special teams unit here.
After that play, I thought they might go for it because they're so deep into the territory. Even if you don't get it, they have to go 97 yards.
And that. I don't know if that was a fake or a botched
snap.
Looked like a bad snap to me. And man, oh man. It was a high snap, and then it was bobbled. Yeah. So Seth Mayer had no chance at kicking it. And honestly, it was a good play by.
That's the third string quarterback number.
By
18.
Number 18, Nate Szymanski, who he grabbed it, tried to look for someone downfield, and. What a way to end the drive.
Unfortunately.
Plenty of highs and lows on that possession if you're an Eagles fan.
But how about Szymanski? His dad's a guy that makes the trip down from Michigan, the Detroit area, for every single game to watch his son play.
That's pretty cool. That's really cool. And so here we go. Eagles defense back out there as they trot out there. And it's going to be number three. And we've seen the rotating quarterbacks now every drive of this second half. Again, it's Braxton Baugus out there for the Wildcats.
Well, after that last throw, I thought we might see him for the rest of the game. That was a pretty impressive throw.
Yeah, you're talking about number seven, Nolan Chalbe.
For Chalbe, the way he threw the ball across his body. Now, the offense has been a little bit more consistent moving the football with Ballman in, but when you got that kind of talent and that kind of arm that we saw from Chalbe on that previous drive, you thought maybe – but that's going to be an interesting battle. Maybe they go to a two-quarterback system next year using each player differently.
You never know. It looks like there is a timeout on the field now with 9:33 to go in this one. Bethel leads 48-7.
But that was a lot of good things that happened on that offensive drive. You're able to get the ball. Unfortunately, you had a touchdown called back, but then a nice play by Wobbleman able to get out to his right, Wobbendorf. And able to throw the ball down to the 3-yard line. Holyfield was able to make a nice catch down around the 3-yard line. Unfortunately, it was a bad snap and handle on the field goal try, but a lot of positives to take out of that drive.
Holyfield has played really well today. He's climbed the ladder. I mean, for everything we've talked about Jameson and we've talked about Wommeldorf and them making plays, Holyfield, it doesn't matter who's throwing the ball. The dude jumps up. He's only 6 foot. It's not like he's a giant out there.
Holyfield
he's getting up there and getting it.
He had made a reception all year. Then all of a sudden he comes into this game. He's the main focal point. He's got to have 6-7 catches right now.
Yeah, I mean, he's had a catch, two third down catches, one on fourth, and then that one you just saw here. So first and 10 now on the 2-yard line. It's going to be a handoff left side for Bethel, and CCU stops that. Number 22 in on that tackle, Michael Williams, coming in at the 5-yard line. So a pickup of 3 for the Wildcats.
And they're still not wasting. They're still staying in this. Despite the score, they're staying what they need to do with this no huddle.
I mean, with the backup quarterbacks, and you want to get them used to it, get them accustomed to it. So that's
But I do like the idea that the Bethel coaching staff did. You had the big lead. Let's get the underclassmen some snaps at the quarterback position just in case something happens.
Baugus hands it off again up the middle. Appears to be number 38, Logan Diebold.
Now we have a player down. Oh, no, 31 lost his helmet. And just like in any level of college and high school, you, of course, have to come out for one play.
And that's Diebold. He got up to, let's see where they mark this ball, probably around the 7-yard line. It's going to be 8-yard line, so it'll be 3rd and 4.
And that's
as Carlos we're
Love.
Under 9 minutes to go in this one. Diebold on one side, number 25. Zach Winston on the other side. You have number 3, Braxton Baugus back there, and he's going to roll out to his right, and he finds Diebold up the right side, who falls forward, and that's going to be enough for a first down. Diebold had more room to run, trips up, but it's enough for a Wildcats first down.
But once again, the running back's able to get out of the backfield. Nobody's picking him up, and you have to believe the defensive coordinator, when they're looking at game film and they're talking next week, that it's the linebacker's responsibility to pick up a running back coming out of the backfield. That's 5 or 6 times we've seen that running back come out clean.
So now it's 1st and 10. Baugus in the shotgun, and he's going to hand it off right up the middle. And that's number 25 on the handoff, Zach Winston, and he gets up to about the 22-yard line or so.
Still getting a good push up front is Bethel, even with some of the reserves end of the game. And the running backs do a very good job about finishing their runs, always falling forward, able to lower their shoulder there at the end.
So here we go. It'll be 2nd down, and it's a quick screen pass on the left side. That's to Diebold. Diebold makes a man miss. Michael Williams going to bring him down, and that's going to be a gain there, a decent gain up the left side. Let's see where they mark it. It's going to be enough to extend the drive here. It looks like he got beyond the first down marker.
just because the backup's in, you've seen a lot of more of these three and four wide receiver sets.
They're in shotgun again. First and 10, it'll be a handoff. Right side, nope, it's a keeper up the left side. And the quarterback's off to the races.
Everybody bet on that play, Fage.
Yep, and Baugus gets all the way down. We haven't seen his legs much today, if at all. I think that's the first time, but Mikel Marble there to prevent the touchdown. And you see it, he faked me out, keeps it, faked out the entire CCU defense. No one there. Outruns a CCU defender, and Marble there just in time to push him out of bounds.
Baugus was
no huddle here. Baugus handoff right side. And the running back, number 26, Breland McKinney, able to pick up about 4 or 5 yards.
Baugus, that's his first rushing attempt of the season. But with this kind of offense that they run, they're just trying to wear you down. And then in the fourth quarter, just impose their will on you. And that's sort of what we're seeing here. Those holes are starting to get a little bit bigger and a little bit bigger for Bethel University.
So here we go. Shotgun. Two runners in the backfield. A handoff up the middle. Gain of about 3 yards or so there. And again, that's number 26, Breland McKinney on the carry. Just under 6 minutes to go here in this one. It's going to be third down. No huddle now for Bethel. Third and short. Going to run out of the shotgun again now for Baugus. And Baugus, he's going to hand it off again. And is it going to be enough for the first? It looks like it is. Logan Diebold again now, and he picks up the first down as the clock continues to tick, tick, tick. And Bethel really getting the running game going, keeping the clock moving as they continue this drive.
Just getting 5-6 yards a pop. Just keep the clock moving and keep the chains moving as well. False start on Bethel. That'll push him back 5 yards, but 5:22 to go. You'd like to see the defense come up with a stop and give your offense one more chance to put some more points on the board as they had some taken away on that last drive.
There's no doubt about that. I mean, the CCU offense has flashed multiple times today, unable to put it completely together. The more chances, the better off you are heading into next week. And this is going to be a slant to Diebold, and the fullback is just in the mix today in the passing game, and he's going to get it down to the 18-yard line. And that's a big gain there, or a manageable gain, but it's going to make this play a lot more manageable after the penalty.
But you see Marble coming from a strong safety position just a second too late, allowing the fullback to once again catch that ball out of the slot as they spread him out four wide once again.
And this is going to be a run on the left side. CCU read it. Not much room there at all for Braxton Baugus. And this is going to bring up third down.
That's the best defensive play they've had all night. They were able to get two defensive players into the backfield. They took the dive away. Then they had two guys waiting on the edge for the quarterback. As you can tell, he's not comfortable as a runner. He more wants to throw the football. He just went to his knees. Didn't want to try to get any more than he had to and not turn over the football. But great defensive play there by the Eagle defense.
So here we go. Third and 8 on the 18. Clock right at 4 minutes as it continues to tick in this ball game. Baugus going to look for the end zone. He's got a man.
Great
and
play.
And it's batted down. And that, what a play there by number 7. And that's Trevor Rabichaud on that one. And let's watch it one more time here. He's able to get that left hand out there.
Looked like he was beat at first, but good closing speed, as you said, able to get that left arm out. And now Bethel's going to go for it on fourth down. Trip to the top.
Fourth and 8, they're going for it. They take the snap, handoff, nope. And there's a penalty, and it looks like it'll be a false start to back them up more.
Miles delay, yeah. Might have been a delay. Now they're going to get offsides on the offense.
What?
Not one you see every day. Wide receiver lined up offsides.
Wow. You don't see that every day.
That's not a penalty you see every day.
No. Either way, though, benefits the Eagles. It'll be fourth Fourth and 13 now.
Kind of surprised that they didn't even try to attempt a field goal. You're up 48-7. A chance to try your new field goal unit out here. Instead, they're going to go ahead and just roll the offense out there.
I think part of it is because their normal kicker isn't here, and they just they don't want to get that punter out there. All right, so Braxton Baugus backed up even more, and it's going to be a play action.
Trying to set the screen. Great play by the defensive line. Beautiful play defensively.
Yep, and no one open downfield.
97, 44, and 38 all jumped on the tailback coming out. And now we have a flag, a late flag back at the 6. That ball was uncatchable. It was out of bounds. There was no way they could call that any kind of a pass interference.
Well, the thing is when I looked over after the ball was thrown, the Wildcats, I think it was 84, he was blocking. So it's not like he was in position to make a catch anyway.
Well, they're sending the offense out there is CCU. So they have to believe this is on Bethel. They'll decline the penalty. Unless it's a post-whistle, then, of course, they'll get the free 15 at the end. Is 3:44 to go, and we have to have another conference that's going to take about just as long.
Well, they're going to pick up the flag. Here we go.
That's what it is, pass interference on the offense. They're going to decline it. As you said, you can never block while the football's in the air as they were trying to set up that screen pass. But give a shout-out to that CCU defense. Three guys recognize that screen play right off the bat.
All right, so first and 10, CCU. Wammeldorf is going to keep it. Struggled there, and he keeps it up the left side, breaks a couple tackles, and he's just so slippery.
Fortunate he didn't take that to the house.
Really slippery, man, and you're right. I mean, a couple of these here and there, and he's going to take one at some point. He almost did on that one.
But I really do like the way the directions this offense is moving. We remember them in week one, and they started to make some strides against Georgetown. Well, the scoreboard doesn't show it, but the way they've moved the ball in between the 20s, they've really shown a lot of progress, and you have to like the way they're moving forward. Like Coach Folt said at the top, the easy part of the schedule comes at the end.
And we will get into that schedule shortly here. Second and 3, handoff right side. That's Jordan Frost, and he fumbles it, and it's going to be recovered by the Wildcats. That's number 43, Tristan Wood, on the recovery, and that's not something you expect to see from Jordan Frost. He fumbles it there when he had a first down.
I think you're going to see him trying to pick up the extra yard or two at the end, and that ball is just going to get poked out. Right? No good arm tackle. Able to poke it away. That's how you're taught to tackle. Great play there by the defensive lineman. Couldn't be able to pick up his number, but went in and able to poke that one out. Good play there defensively, though, by Bethel.
And why the CCU offense jogs off the field, defense coming back on the field. Next time we will be with you is October 29th against Kentucky Christian University right here at Betts Memorial Stadium.
And that's now
you can watch us at ccuathletics.com and Waycross TV.
You saw the press release. Now the two colleges have combined in regards to leadership council as well. CCU sent out a press release.
That's a fumble on this, and it looks like CCU recovered the handoff there. That was Chaube in at quarterback. So what – two plays, two fumbles, two changes of possession. And you see there was just a fumbled exchange there. The running back never had it. That was number 29, Octavian Burrell. And Burrell doesn't get it. CCU recovers. So one more shot now for the Eagles offense with 2:50 to go in this one.
And now they bring Payne back in at wide receiver, a guy that started the season as the number one, kind of got demoted a little bit to number three, trying to earn his way back up. And when you see the play of Holyfield, you understand a little bit. He's kind of earned that spot, but now Payne trying to get some reps here and earn his way back up to that top 1-2 wide receiver spot.
So Wammeldorf under center again. First and 10 on his own 36. He's going to fake the handoff, and he's going to keep it left side, and he's got some room. First down and more, and he's going to get into Wildcats territory, and he's down to about the 48, they're going to mark it at right at the 50-yard line now with 2:53 to go. First down, Eagles.
It was a good decision to keep it, but I still think you at least have to look at your pitch, man, and at least try to sell that a little bit. He knew he was going to hit that corner and go, but to help sell it out to the defense, you need to at least give the illusion that you will pitch that football.
Wummeldorf making play after play with his legs today. We've seen multiple plays, and now can he do it a couple more times and lead the Eagles downfield? And there's the pitch you were talking about. Jordan Frost has room on the right side, and he's down to the 40, the 35, cuts back down to the 20, and it's a foot race, and he cuts back one more time, and he's going to go all the way into the end zone. Touchdown, Jordan Frost, and the Eagles score here, and it'll be 48-13. Frost cutting it back all the way across field. And that, there you go. You mentioned the pitch. There's the pitch, the catch, and a great piece of running from Jordan Frost. That's his first carry after the fumble, and you see he's such a playmaker for this Eagles offense.
And for Jordan Frost, his first touchdown rush of the season, but
multiple cutback.
His second longest run of the year. He had a 65-yarder earlier this season
against Georgetown a couple weeks back that set up a touchdown.
But that 50-yarder to the house.
Seth Mayer on for the extra point. And the Eagles offense gets on the board there. And after the touchdown was negated last drive, they get the touchdown here. It's about building momentum. As we look at the Eagles schedule here, they'll be at Urbana University next week. That's a 1 o'clock game. Then at University of Pikeville and at Bluefield College. So they have three games on the road before they return here to Betts Memorial Stadium, when they'll take on Kentucky Christian University, and they'll close the season at Campbellsville University. So 4 out of 5 on the road now for this Eagles team. We've seen them twice out of the past 3 weeks, against Georgetown and then today. They have things that they've built on. They've improved, and I think they just have to continue that as they – this is their first season, a lot of young players, and this is something they just got to continue to keep building on as the season goes
all
on.
All freshmen.
Yep.
A lot of freshmen. New system, no winter conditioning, no spring practice. Now next year, they get all that. They get to hit the weights in the wintertime. They get that spring practice, spring game. Then you hit the summer practice in August, and now you're getting your name out there. We see the recruits here every week. But then next year, you're looking at a 6-game home schedule, as the schedule should reverse to 4 road, 6 home.
And there's an onside kick, a little bit of a pooch kick. It's recovered by 86, Marvin Rudd, and Rudd just downs it at the 40-yard line.
Smart play. Just fall on the football, get your offense back on the field, milk the last 2:06. But you really do have to like the direction, especially the way TJ took the reins and was moving his football. Like I said earlier, it doesn't show in point-wise what TJ did, but this offense between the 20s was moving the ball just fine earlier. They just have to learn how to start finishing drives a little bit.
And I will say this. I think between Jameson and Wommeldorf, they both have their strengths. Strengths are pretty good. I mean, between both guys, they both quarterback this team 4 touchdowns today. So 2:06 go to here. And it's going to be a screen pass up the right side for the Wildcats, the number 44. The fullback stumbles and bumbles for about 5 yards. That's Josh Williams and his first reception of the day. You also have Nolan Chalbay back under center. We've seen him multiple times today.
And I think eventually, you're talking about young freshmen that came from quarterback systems in high school that were a lot of run, predominant run, and they're going to learn to start trusting their eyes and stuff as they get more involved. And you start to see that from TJ a little bit this afternoon before he got pulled here at the end, but they're only going to get better.
Chalbay now is going to keep it. That is going...
Great play there, big up front, big old number 91.
And Chalbay, you see him right there on the keeper, unable to do anything with it, and CCU right in the backfield. 91 was there first, Trevor Williamson. Big play for the Cincinnati Christian defense and brings up third down for the Wildcats. As we approach 1 minute in this game at Betts Memorial Stadium, clock continues to tick down.
And I think that's one thing, looking for somebody to step up. First game without a big number 99 in there as well.
And you say, and they're going to pass it on third down. Chalbay looking downfield, has his fullback, and he's brought down on the play, shy of the first down. And that's number 38, Derek Craig, on the tackle.
And that should about do it. But and they're not throwing it to try to run up the score. I mean, they're literally trying to get third and fourth string quarterbacks ready to go. And
absolutely,
I think that's the difference than what we saw with Georgetown a couple weeks ago, where they were really trying to score as they pumped in that touchdown with 20 seconds when there was no need for it, as they were just running a simple fullback flat.
And that's going to do it here at Betts Memorial Stadium. Cincinnati Christian showed flashes. They improved today, and they certainly, scoring two touchdowns today at home, showed that they're improving and getting better in their first season here. The final score here, number 23, Bethel University 48, Cincinnati Christian University 14. For Rob Roberts and the production crew, I'm James Erpine. We'll be back with you October 29th when Kentucky Christian University comes here to Betts Memorial Stadium. Before that, CCU will take on at Urbana University next week. You can monitor that at CCUathletics.com. I appreciate you watching here on Waycross TV and CCU Athletics. He was Rob Roberts. I'm James Erpine. Have a great day, and thank you for watching.